What's up, everybody? Welcome to the Game Over Greggy Show. I am one of your hosts, Greg Miller, alongside the producer slash seducer, Nick Scarpino.
Hello.
Hey, how are you?
I'm doing well, thanks, Greg.
Looking good. The beard's
Greg, you
good.
Survived VidCon.
I did survive VidCon.
Barely.
And by the time this posts, hopefully RTX.
Oh, RTX is going to be so good.
It's gonna be so good. Austin.
So good.
We're going to eat a lot of food.
We're going to eat a ton of food. Oh. All barbecue, all lean protein, I'm hoping.
No, I'm going to I'm gonna go to that Gordo's. Yeah. Over here! The pride of Long Island, Colin Moriarty.
Go Islanders.
Go Islanders indeed. And our special guest from Giant Bomb, Jeff Gerstmann.
Oh,
how you doing?
How's it going?
Hello.
We
gotta celebrate.
I said I wouldn't come if you guys didn't clap.
We almost blew it.
Yeah.
We almost blew it right up.
Okay, all right. Now
you're just fine.
All right, good.
Thank you for coming.
Yeah, no, I'm glad to be here.
Tim Geddes had the audacity to have a birthday and go to Austin to celebrate with his girlfriend and wait for RTX to start.
Gross.
Jerk.
Is RTX amazing? I've never been.
We never have either.
Okay, well, they're supposed to after RTX. No, it doesn't.
Well, the...
Does it?
Of course, everybody. If you,
yeah, it was fantastic. You guys had a great time.
So good. Bernie's awesome.
The reason there's we don't know if it's up after RTX is the fact that the Game Over Greggy Show posts every Friday as an MP3 on GameOverGreggy.bandcamp.com for $1. If you don't think we're worth that dollar, you can pick us up on YouTube Monday through Friday. Every topic's broken out one by one. YouTube.com/GameOverGreggy. We post them for free over there. So that's why we don't know. Currently, if you're listening to the MP3 on Friday, RTX is happening. You probably just missed the Game Over Greggy Show panel we're doing there with Barbara Dunkelman.
It's going to be so good with Barbara.
They're live streaming it, and then we'll put up the video, of course, here, if everything goes according to plan. Mm. You never know with that technical stuff.
Yeah, that's very fancy.
Yeah, it's a pain in the butt.
Especially with me running it. I just twist knobs constantly.
Doing video on the road, it's just like at any moment, like it might all just catch on fire. I don't know. These cameras all got stolen. Who knows?
It's funny, like, and I hate the differences when you go place to place. Yep. Like, I've been to PAX where they're like, don't touch the board. We are union workers now. And then at PAX East this year, they were like, oh yeah, go ahead, jack on the board. We don't care. I was like, damn, all right.
Yeah.
Jerks. No idea what's happening over there, Colin.
Fucking asshole.
Don't jack into
these
the board.
Unions, right? You're a big union fan.
I'm a huge union.
Colin, don't jack the board.
I'm not going to jack. I might. Never mind. I was gonna say, maybe I'll jack off on the board. But is that appropriate?
Yeah, I said it, fine.
So it's
I know. I like you how you stopped yourself.
Okay. No, let's roll this back.
Yeah, you can't.
Guys.
What's up, everybody? Welcome.
I'm here to kind of train you guys for pure internet celebrity. Look, just roll it back. The jack off thing, not cool.
Yeah, no. A little creepy. A little perverted.
It's about time a real producer came in here.
Yeah, exactly. Thank you. Can you please take over? Every single time we say something inappropriate, Greg makes me bleep it.
No, see, I make him bleep when he mentions people's names he shouldn't mention.
Okay.
Such as whose dick he'd want to trade, and he throws out a person that there's no reason he should say that person's name on the air. That's why we have to bleep Nick Scarpino.
It's classic Scarpino.
Classic.
Classic.
That's what everyone says. Classic Scarpino.
Another classic Scarpino moment. That SOB.
I'm staring at that milkshake now. I want one of those milkshakes.
Yeah, there's a Game Over Greggy Show video going up about the perfect Portillo's order. If you're listening to MP3 on Friday, it'll be live on Saturday. And if you're listening after Saturday, it's live on Saturday.
Gonna make you hungry. I'm just putting it out there.
I'm dying to go back to Portillo's.
It's the best.
Seeing
it's
just
the best
this,
thing in the
this
world.
Like 20 seconds of video that I saw over here right now, like ignited it in me all over again. I've only been there like four times because you know it's like I'm from here,
enough.
So
yeah,
you know, it's always like
enough.
I can.
But
I
you're
can,
down in LA enough. You gotta get to that Buena Park.
I am. Yeah. The last time I went, I ended up really screwing myself over because I was driving back to San Francisco from LA, and then in the time it took me to drive back down there and back to LA where I was to begin with. I-5 had caught on fire.
Oh,
so
sure.
It took me a day and a half to get home.
You should have packed a second Portillo's lunch.
So I did.
Yeah.
And so I was in a Motel 6, like, late that night, just with the one Portillo's, just the sandwich going, there's a microwave in this room. This is perfect. And just, like, eating it and just, like, watching baseball on, like, a 4x3 TV and just going, like, sandwich loves me. And, God, I want to go back.
You got to, every year after E3, I take a pilgrimage down there. You should come.
Yeah.
Yeah, big time.
Man.
Yeah, big time. Colin.
Yes.
Jeff, of course, is a guest here today.
Yes.
But we have another guest with us.
Yes.
Explain to me this fancy bottle of bourbon.
So we have here, oh dear, the pop filter. Henry McKenna, 10-year bourbon.
Uh-huh.
Now, people might remember, maybe it was 15, 20 episodes ago, we had David Ballard on from Naughty Dog, our friend at Naughty Dog. Our friend Eric Castro, another friend. We have more than one friend.
We have so many friends.
And
in the show.
Eric Castro.
Choose one, guys. Come on.
Oh.
It's really hard. You only have a few
Eric
good
Castro.
Friends.
Tom
in the
Hanks.
World.
aim high.
So Eric Castro owns Polite Provisions, which is a fantastic cocktail bar in San Diego, and everyone that watches this show know that Greg and I love our old fashions. So he's a good friend of ours, and so he sent us five bottles. if people remember correctly. They're little vials, they're little Castlevania vials. And we sampled all five bourbons, which were all private barrels, and then we picked the barrel that he would use for his house bourbon.
Right.
And he sent us 9 bottles of the bourbon.
Whew! That's an expensive thing on bourbon.
So
there.
First of all, Eric Castro is the man. We really appreciate that. So what Thanks, it says, Eric Castro. We picked out... Wow. Yep. Yeah, please report. We picked out barrel number 1225 from the year 2003.
Mm-hmm.
This was barreled on 10-6-03, October 6, 2003. When I was at Northeastern University, still, so
the world
was
a different place back then.
Very different, very mm-hmm. different place. We had a little bit last night. I was on the comedy button last night with Altano and Scott Bromley and those guys. I came home. We had a little bit of this.
Yeah.
We were playing Valiant Hearts.
It was good.
So we're gonna sample it now again and pretend we never had it before.
Oh, okay.
And it just smells. I mean, this is some. Usually we drink Knob Creek. We drink Woodford.
Right.
Pretty Eagle Rare, good stuff. But this is better than all of that.
Right. Because we made it.
Exactly, we made.
If it wasn't for us, McKenna, this wouldn't even be in Polite Provisions.
1, 2,
another
2, 5.
One. Yeah, Pashaw. Come on.
So we'll get those poured.
Everybody go to San Diego. Of course, I'll be at Comic Con. I'll be hosting.
Go to San Diego.
I'll be hosting a meet and greet at Polite Provisions, San Diego Comic Con.
Sounds lovely.
Probably
can I
nothing.
Come?
Yeah, probably nothing will be free. So bring money.
No,
yeah.
But
cash.
Yeah,
lots of cash.
And come with that love of. Good cocktail
of handcrafted cocktails.
Oh, it takes a few minutes to make them. You know, mm-hmm. But it's so you know. But when I went there with Cheryl when we were in San Diego,
his girlfriend.
It's my girlfriend.
His girlfriend.
Ooh. They had a guy in there that was chipping the ice manually, which was like so cool.
That yeah. seems
it's
that's,
so old
I'm
school.
Sorry, now I got to draw the line at that. Like right. that seems like
Perfect.
It's going to take
I
too long.
Drink. Cheers.
You can't just make the ice.
Thanks for coming, Jeff.
It's soda. Yeah,
thank you, Eric.
Yeah. What were you saying? Make
you
your fucking
you just,
point.
You can't just put ice in a glass. You got to chip away at it with your cool vests and your bow tie and your suspenders.
It's a show.
You more than most people, I think, would be a man who understands fine ice.
I do you, enjoy my ice.
You need the fine ice when you're paying $10, $12, $14 for a cocktail. They put all the love and respect into that cocktail.
See, if I could pay $8 for that cocktail and just get ice
get
cubes,
fast.
You'd be all right with that.
I'd be all right with that.
Okay. Now, here's the thing I was thinking about. You guys haven't been in the bar yet, so you can tell me when you go. It's like an old school kind of early 20th century inspired vibe there, like a soda fountain kind of almost. And they have some old paintings, some old portraits. Now
the
I
eyes,
wonder,
the eyes move with,
kind of like the Tickly Monster back in the day.
The Tickly
and
Monster.
I was wondering, would Eric adorn Polite
oh
Provisions
God.
With this portrait?
If we
okay, well, it can't be that one.
We got to send him another
one. Because I'm married to this one,
yeah.
But I'm sure
we can get
Panda
another.
Would do another one of these for us if we wanted
yeah.
to, if it was going to be hung someplace as magical.
That's amazing.
As
Eric
Castro,
you got to let us know if you'll
yeah.
hang
well,
that.
Bare minimum, if you're going to do a meetup down there, I mean, bring
sure,
this one with
sure,
you.
Sure, that's a good
hope
call.
Hope it doesn't get destroyed. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
What's crazy is I never really realized that at this angle, Colin is looking right at me. So as you're looking at me, you're also looking at
My
me.
Favorite part is like last week, I was like,
it's
hey,
trippy.
Nick, this
it's
is trippy. Really crooked. And you said, it looks good on camera. And then I watched the show and it did.
Oh, no. Yeah. If you look at it right now, it looks like it's what like...
It's way crooked.
Yeah.
But
it looks
fine
like I hung
on
it.
That thing.
Yeah.
But that's weird.
I know.
Oh, man, angles.
Angles.
The camera adds 10 pounds and 2 inches that way.
Which way was that?
That way.
Yeah, okay. That sounds about right.
Yeah. Normal. Ladies and gentlemen, the Game Over Greggy show is simple. Every week, 4, sometimes 5 best friends gather around this table. He's bringing a random topic of discussion for your amusement. You hopefully like it, share it, you buy the podcast. We already went through all that part of it. Don't worry about it.
Yeah.
Jeff.
Hi.
You're the guest.
Hello.
First off, everybody should know you, right? You're like Mr. Video Games Journalism.
I guess so. Yeah, something like that. Sure.
In a nutshell, who are you if they don't know you?
Let's see. I mean, I've been covering video games for about like 20 years now, which is kind of a long time. And currently doing it at giantbomb.com. And follow me on Twitter or go to jeffgerstmann.net where I'm answering all kinds of questions and doing all kinds of dumb shit.
Okay, great.
Yeah.
What dumb shit did you bring today as your topic?
Well, look, guys, I'm at this conundrum. Like, the quality of my life is questionable at this point because I watch wrestling, and I hate wrestling, and I can't stop watching wrestling.
So why do you watch it? Why do you keep watching wrestling?
Because you can't stop.
Because I can't stop watching wrestling.
You don't know how an addiction works?
Oh, I know
Nick
how addictions
Scarpino.
Work. And let me tell you right now, I'll be first to tell you, I started watching Total Divas, can't stop watching that
See,
show.
See, I can't get that deep into it. Oh. Look, man, you have a different strain of crazy.
That's,
I can't handle it.
It's, yeah,
you
it's,
are too far gone. Look, you need some mutants.
No one can
You need help, man.
I actually, this is how bad it is. My wife comes, she's like, "That show, why are you watching that show?" I was like, "It's kind of funny." She starts watching the show. Mm-hmm. I come back a week later from a trip. She's seen all of them. She now wants to go back on Xbox Live and buy the first season of the show.
Oh, boy.
So we do it. and I watch it. And now I'm like, now I have to watch the second season of the show that you already watched. Mm-hmm. It's a great show.
It is, oh, well, yeah. That's oh, debatable.
Super good.
So
it,
my problem
it goes Total Divas, Breaking Bad,
Jesus God,
Game of Thrones, and then whatever. I don't care.
I'm my two dads.
So tell us the issue at hand.
So I think, you know, my larger issue is I feel like that's something that you know, like wrestling was good for a little bit, then it's you know, the writing has gotten worse lately, and it is what it is. But I think the larger issue there is I feel like, you know, there are a lot of things that appeal to. I hesitate to even call it like a geek demographic because I think it's like a really reductive way to talk about it. But, you know, like the people that are passionate about things on the internet in an extreme way, comic books, science fiction movies, video games, wrestling, like all these things kind of fit together, you know, horror movies, whatever it ends up being. People, it's fine that people are passionate about it, but people are just tearing things apart. And it feels like that just every conversation online that I'm in nowadays, it's just extreme one way or the other. It's all it's either this is the best thing in the world or this is fucking trash garbage.
It's a user critic on Metacritic.
Basically,
it's either a zero or a 10.
It's either it's either like Ubisoft lied to us or it's the greatest thing ever made. And it's I just don't know if there's a way to change it. I mean, obviously, you know, like my problem is with wrestling. You know, it has its ups and downs. I hate it. But sometimes it's really great.
Now, have you been following? Catch me up here, because you know, you guys all go way back, but we haven't really interacted that much.
He came up at noon,
which is sad. I know, but he came in like a superstar and then left like 5 seconds later. Like, I don't want to take any pictures.
Who the hell is this beard guy?
I'm not taking pictures. I'm not going to do anything. Have you been watching wrestling since you were a kid?
So I watched it a lot as a kid, kind of the Hulk Hogan era, right?
Yeah.
You
know,
the era. The era. And then,
see, I say Attitude Era was the whatever.
So I fell out of it.
Yeah,
I fell out of it and kind of.
They know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, I fell out of it. Kind of came back when the NWO got big.
Yep.
And so because it became like the storyline got a little edgier, a little more reality based, to where you were like it blurred the lines.
Yeah.
Obviously, you knew it was still being written. It was still a show, but the storylines had become more than just like I'm gonna beat the bad guy.
Right.
And then you beat the bad guy, and now you have and the championship the belt.
But who is like, the bad guy?
The Undertaker, or you know, anyone.
Undertaker,
Giant Gonzalez.
Undertaker was literally crucifying people.
Yeah,
in this
exactly.
Era.
Like that's.
Didn't The Rock start as a bad guy?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And he's gone back a few times.
Yeah, everyone kind of goes back and forth. It's just, you know, at some point they're like, well, this is boring, and the people aren't responding to it the way they used to, so we need to swing them over to the other side.
Gotcha.
And surprise everybody, and then we can ride that out for 6 weeks.
Gotcha.
Except for John Cena, I guess. Well, he, you know, maybe started out a little bit of a bad guy, but he's just become just Superman. He is the new Hulk Hogan. He never loses.
You were saying earlier that he won something.
Yes, he won back the championship
Money
recently.
Money in the Bank was over.
Money
in
the Bank. They gave him the title of the pay-per-view. And, you know, so now he has the belts again for like 15 times or whatever it is. And,
is he still wearing the jorts?
Oh yeah,
it's cargo shorts sometimes.
He mixes in the jorts.
Yeah,
they're still there.
And it's that I'm torn on that too because I've got a closet full of jean shorts, guys.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Like I'm just one of these days they're gonna come back.
They come back out.
They're gonna come back.
How did you find out you were out of style with jorts?
I wore them. I was kind of like hanging on to them for a while,
really?
And going like, no, fuck you guys. I'm right. You're wrong.
Yeah. For me, I was out. I wore them all through college.
Mm-hmm.
All through college wore these jorts.
I want to see pictures of you in jorts.
Remember this is I was
telling
this story.
Hair.
Yeah, this is the story of how I walked into my freshman year. Mind you, I'd gone to private Catholic school my entire life,
sure.
So they finally let me off the leash.
Oh yeah,
knowing how to dress
snapped,
myself.
Yeah.
So this is—I walked into my college dorm freshman year, first day, with from the feet to the head, right? Red Converse high tops.
Okay.
Tube socks up to the mid calf there.
Definitely.
Then jean shorts.
Mm-hmm.
Then a WCW T-shirt.
Naturally.
Hawaiian shirt over it.
Oh yeah.
Because there was a Simpsons episode, remember, with the gay guy, and Homer said only two kinds of guys wear Hawaiian shirts: big fat party animals or gay guys. And I was like, I want to be a big fat party animal.
Absolutely.
And so I'm not even making this up, every day of freshman year I wore a Hawaiian shirt.
I own three Hawaiian shirts.
So then you go
really
up the rest of the way. I'd finally been able to get the nerd glasses I always wanted, and then I had blue hair, completely dyed royal blue hair.
Perfect.
And so I was ready to party for sure.
Yeah.
But so over the years I grew out of a lot of that. You know, sophomore year I didn't wear the Hawaiian shirts as much. I mixed in other wrestling shirts and video games and whatnot.
Mm-hmm.
And then I was out to dinner and I'd already graduated college, or I was about to graduate. I'm sorry, it was my senior year. And I was out there, blah, blah, and it was my girlfriend at the time, that her friends, whatever, yada, yada. And they're like, well, yeah, you know, jean shorts are out of style, but Miller kind of makes them work. And I was like, excuse me? And I was, and they're like, no, jean shorts aren't. And I'm like, really?
Like, what happened?
And they're like, well, who is the only other person you know who else wears jean shorts? And I had one friend. They're like, is he cool? And I was like, no.
No, wait a minute. What
if fuck? I and I like the yeah. next day went out and bought.
Ripped yeah. them off and you just naked with your balls out.
Well, it's, you know, I just didn't know any better.
The phase I went through is that I got to a point where I didn't own any long pants at all.
Mm.
And it's, you know, living in, the, in this part, you know, San Francisco, it's mild.
Yeah.
We work inside.
Yeah.
Clearly.
So, yeah, I know, right?
Can't tell about the tan.
Yeah. So basically, I didn't need to wear pants.
Yeah.
So I didn't, man.
Yeah.
So I ended up with, you know, a lot of pairs of jean shorts and, you know, some non-jean shorts, but mostly jean shorts. And this, you know, this kind of carried on actually until like way past its prime. Like, you know, it was kind of like 2006, 2007.
Okay. Oh, wow, okay. So it's pretty recent.
2008 maybe. yeah, somewhere in there.
She's like 2000, you know, yesterday.
Yes, last month I decided. Right now. So I had kind of a full-on snap where I'm like, this is fucking ridiculous. Like, what am I doing? I dress myself. I can do better than this.
Yeah.
So I kind of started shopping. I was like, you know what? I'm just going to... So I went out and I just said, like, I'm going to spend a lot of money on one pair of jeans and see how it goes. And I went and I bought, like, you know, Japanese raw denim and, like, all the, you know, fancy, you know, weird pants that you're not supposed to wash and all that bullshit.
Yeah, yeah.
And bought them and liked them. And I was like, okay, no, wait. I can wear some pants. I can,
yeah. You know.
And now I'm proud to say...
You wear pants.
I own three pairs of jeans.
Nice.
Wow, congratulations.
Yeah. See, this it's, is... That's nice. I had been wearing the relaxed fit jeans forever,
mm-hmm.
and there's this girl at work who says that's not a good look on me, and my her name's Alexa. She's been on the show.
She, I don't know I why think I said her exact words... I know, exactly. We had her guess. Her exact words were, you look like you're holding a load in your pants.
Yeah, they
were,
I got a saggy ass.
You got a saggy, so, sure, old man. Yeah, you got yeah. the Harrison
Nick
Ford
wanted
butt
to film,
from Crystal Skull.
Yeah, Nick wanted to film some fancy conversations at IGN, so he took me out with a budget and bought me nice pants. Mm-hmm. And I was like, and now they're like all skinny, and they're nice and tight on my ass.
Yeah.
Sometimes too tight on my good. Dick, I get told. But I like that look.
Well, yeah, you, because you hike them up.
Again!
So high.
Again! You the, wear, the point is...
Wear them like my grandma used to wear her sweatpants when she
because
went to the base.
You, I don't want a saggy butt anymore. And like you have to understand, I'm still wearing them the way the pants are supposed to be worn. Otherwise, when
it's
I bend
like
down,
dad.
You get that ass crack. I'm fighting against the plumber's crack.
I'm too. Trying to get that ass crack out there. I'm putting on shows.
I follow your ass crack on Twitter.
Oh, yeah. It's got good. Quite the following.
His ass quack. I just said that.
Yeah, so you know, sometimes I have to wear a belt because you know, it's like I went through a phase where I actually dropped a little bit of weight, and then these pants started falling off my ass. Well, thank you. It's quitter, but you know,
everyone's quitting. Fat. Everyone's yeah, quitting.
No one's quitting Team Fat.
I'm
buy
quit.
A Team
I
Fat T-shirt.
No,
Discogrames.com/GameOverGreggy.
Man, it's you know,
what are you rocking?
Orders of magnitude.
You rocking XL or double XL?
I'm between right now.
Okay, depends on that's a tough place to be.
It's a tough place to be. People ask you like, "What size shirt you wear?" I got one here for you. Like I don't know how to answer this.
I don't know.
I'm just going to say XL because I feel bad if I say double XL, but that's usually the safe answer. And well.
My answer is always because I'm in between a medium and a large because just because of my pregnant gut.
Because you're baby.
And my question is always, is the shirt pre-shrunk?
Oh.
That's how I always preface it. And usually the answer is, I have no idea. And right. then I'm like, well.
Can't take that. You can't take that risk.
No, dude. Because I have some,
you can't
I have
take
some
pre-shrunk
shirts.
Risk.
I have some shirts. Like the Dr. Wiley shirt that Greg bought me in Japan.
Yeah.
Was a large that shrunk down perfectly to a medium. Mm. Now, I bought a resistance shirt that was a medium, not pre-shrunk, that looks like a fucking belly shirt. You know? So you have to be, like, very careful. Even my Resogun shirt.
Yeah.
Very careful with that kind of stuff.
That's now, the worst.
Like, when you get, raise yeah, your hand yeah. to right here, I can see your entire navel.
Yeah, it's ridiculous. It's totally ridiculous. Now, before we move on to the rest of the wrestling story, I just want to say, as an aside...
This is the rest of the wrestling story, so don't worry about it.
Okay.
Yeah.
I just want to say, as an aside, before we get any... further away, the fact Greg's my best friend. I've known Greg for a long time. The fact that Greg wore Hawaiian shirts every day when he was a freshman at Mizzou makes me want to drop kick him out of a fucking window.
Whatever. And you had a mohawk.
I did have a mohawk.
Mohawks are cool. Still cool.
I did have
Hawaiian
a mohawk.
Shirts are cool. Still cool.
I used to.
I would expect someone with a mohawk to drop kick someone in a Hawaiian shirt. Oh, yeah. I think that checks out. That checks out.
Huh? We would have been best friends.
Oh yeah. Oh no doubt. We were two peas in a pod.
Vandals.
Oh yeah. The Vandals. Oh, I used to wear my dad's. When I was a freshman, I went to school in Boston. It was very cold. My dad had a pea coat of New York City. You know, he's a New York City firefighter, so he had a pea coat with the FDNY logo. And I used to wear it like a fucking Civil War general walking around Boston. It was very very slick. And Ramon. My good friend from college brought some pictures and showed them to me, and I'm wearing that coat in like every picture.
Yeah,
that's cool though. See, you were punk rock. Punk rock's always cool. Punk rock is a classic look.
I was punk something.
You're punk.
Greg going home and watching writing strategy guides on GameFAQs in my spare time. I was very punk rock.
And I haven't seen a picture of Greg
from college.
But I imagine that you were just a giant nerd.
Yeah. Well, it was me with blue hair and a Hawaiian shirt. Okay.
You ever think about going back to the blue hair?
Yeah. I got this white spot, you know, from where my hair grew back. This white spot came with it. I think about dying every so often.
What if you dyed it blue and then the white spot, it didn't take on the white?
And then the white spot for some reason can't take color.
Leave that and, you know, deliberately dye around the white spot. Own the white smirk.
It's very distinctive.
Yeah.
Did you bleach your hair and then dye it?
Oh, yeah. Big time.
Yeah.
Okay. You got to bleach it white first?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Oh, God. That's the worst.
I bleached my hair a handful of times over the years. And
did you ever frost your tips? Because I desperately want to frost my tips.
No, but so I would only bleach my hair once and then let it grow out. Like, you would eventually get to that point where it basically was frosted tips.
That's my recollection of every single time I've seen Clements. Is he's always got like that, like half grown out frosted.
Yeah, he's
tip
got
look,
crazy cool hair
because he just does crazy stuff to his hair all the time.
See, that's the thing about mine is I had blue hair, but I wasn't doing anything crazy with it. Like you can just picture me right now with blue hair, and that was it. I have one photo of me with the bleached blonde hair because KU came to town, and they're blue, so I just bleached it blonde. And again, it's still the same comb over hair. It's just like it's just
you bleached. Had a comb over blonde mop.
Well, I mean, how do you? I don't like the term comb over because I'm not combing over anything. I got a part.
Yeah. Okay,
but a lot of people.
That is exactly what I had when I was bleaching my hair too. Yeah. It was, you know, just parted on the left and combed over to the side, and I don't know. I enjoyed it. Blondes have more fun. That's
I don't even remember. What was the original question?
John Cena wears jean shorts.
John Cena wears jean shorts.
That's how this whole tangent happens.
Yeah. No,
this is like for wrestling, right? I have this exact same story you had, right? Where I was into it big time as a kid.
Yeah.
You grow out of it because it's, you know, it's superheroes versus villains. Because
Doink the Clown retires and you don't want to watch it anymore.
True.
Right.
And then I remember when I got to high school, NWO WCW Revenge was the jam, right? And
right.
That's when the WWF game started coming. That's when Attitude hit. That's when Stone Cold rocked.
Like, man, this is crazy. Like it became okay to be into wrestling.
It was
a
brand new product again. Then the problem is like I stuck with that from high school into college, well into college, and then at some point you're just like
what am I doing?
This is the same thing over and over again. I can't do it. And like I feel even when I jump back into it now, I still haven't, there hasn't been that giant shift, you know what I mean? Like I don't know where they pivot to next.
Parts of it I think are super fascinating, and you know, like from like a business perspective, like watching them try to craft that show and try to run their business. So it's like I'm almost looking at it like that way now, which is probably a sad way to watch any piece of entertainment programming, but that's just how it's shaken out.
How's the revenue flow going?
The revenue flow for them is interesting because I mean you can watch what they're pushing at any given moment, right? So you know, it's like, okay, there are Mountain Dew bottles sitting at the announce table, like, you know, American Idol or something would have Coke glasses or something like that.
Or famed Coke,
you know,
glasses.
You can watch what they're pushing at any given moment and how desperately they push it, you can tell how they're doing. So right now, like, they launched the WWE Network, which is their streaming service with all of this back catalog stuff. And you can look at it and go, like, maybe it's not going so well because, like, you watch them push it harder and harder in increasingly simplified ways to like, you know, it started and they launched it and like, okay, then all of a sudden it became, it's like Netflix for wrestling. Like they had to explain it to people who just weren't getting it. And people were like, you get it on a computer or a thing that you hook up to your TV. It's not on your cable. You need to, you know, it's like they're practically at some point just gonna, and they've done this. Like they've done like, here's how you install an app on your iPad.
Yeah.
Go type in WWE. Like you can watch that kind of like desperation mixed with like their amazing quest for like finding mainstream acceptance.
Sure.
It's a lot like porn. Like I don't know if you've spoken with porn stars.
Oh, I have.
So I hung out with Ron Jeremy.
Oh.
No.
And
the name amongst names.
Yeah. I hung out with him backstage at a strip club in Sacramento. And,
all right, slow this conversation. Slow this down.
Yeah, how did all this happen?
So a friend of mine.
Back up a couple feet here.
A friend of mine met Ron Jeremy. So, okay, back in the day, video game trade shows, the video game stuff used to happen at CES.
I know where we're going.
Before E3. So the adult convention was happening at the same time. The same badge got you into both. I was 16, very excited to see the pornography.
Yeah.
So we would go over there, and I would be like, I don't want to talk to any of these women.
We should also preface that when you and I were 16, there was not a huge proliferation of porn everywhere.
Exactly.
You
this was 1992.
Yeah.
There was no Instagram.
There was barely VHS tapes at this point of pornographic material floating around your...
Like, DVD pornography was just like a faraway dream.
Yeah.
So anyway, a friend of mine started doing Ron Jeremy's official website. because you know he's a busy man. Mm-hmm. He needs a website. Yeah. So my friend started doing it, and he's like, "Well, I'm going to go hang out with Ron because I need to update the website. We need to go talk to him about stuff or something." I'm like, "Okay." Didn't realize it was a strip club, but Ron Jeremy was there telling jokes. He went on tour doing stand up.
Yeah, he did. He's got to tell people what's up.
Right.
Usually him.
That's actually, I mean, that is like 90% of his material right there. you have nailed his act. You were perfect. So he was doing that. He had his rap single out, Freak of the Week, with DJ Polo, who did some work with Cool G Rap. Anyway.
Did you make up all those names just now?
No. Cool G Rap and DJ Polo. That's Road to the Riches.
Colin,
Jeff is a rap on this. He's a rap aficionado.
That's true.
Really?
Yeah.
That was my first introduction to Mr. Gersman.
Really?
Yeah. The first time I ever saw you in the flesh. You were rap battling on that Def Jam Rap Star at some video game event we were at.
They had me up on stage for that. I rapped in front of the head of Def Jam. It was super weird. He did not sign me to a deal. I asked. I said, like, I could rap you like this for you.
Dropped the mic in his face.
Yeah, exactly. So at this point, so we are hanging out backstage at a strip club with Ron Jeremy. It's me, the guy who's running a site, and the guy who's currently my roommate, who is a nutcase. They're all anyway. So me and my friend, we're kind of sitting back there, like not really engaged in this conversation. We're backstage at a strip club, going like, "This is ridiculous. Why are we here? Like, are there someone? We're gonna get found out. Someone's gonna ask us to leave." And we're listening to Ron, and so. Anyway, my point about the wrestling kind of desperation is all he wanted to talk about was, "Oh, I was in the South Park guy's movie, Orgasmo. Oh, I was in this music video. Oh, I'm going to be on this TV show." Like, the porn stuff was like nothing. Like, it was the mainstream, anything he could do that would be like wider and maybe like get him out of that. So it was like this kind of like sad thing to watch, because like you could tell he was trying to get out.
Sure.
Or at least get bigger. Not that you need to get them.
I was gonna say, he's stretching, he's getting bigger.
There you go.
What is this new thing
we're
doing?
Yeah, this is a new thing. I saw it in a movie.
No, you didn't.
It's very cool.
It's just a little pound.
Yeah. Now that's race.
It was a Fast and Furious. It was something. I can't remember what it was like.
Of course it's Fast and Furious when you base your life on.
So cool. Oh my god, of course I do.
So he's kind of telling his stories, and like actually so this ended up getting like kind of verified for me later when they put out a documentary on him, but he would kind of doze off and kind of pick up mid sentence. Turns out he has low grade narcolepsy, which is something we kind of suspected they're talking to him, but then the documentary kind of
confirmed
that.
Yeah.
So me, like this whole story is going on, and it's like super weird because there are, you know, nude women getting ready to get out, you know, they're putting on what little they're putting on to go take off on stage as we're backstage at a strip club. So I'm trying not to look over at that. But meanwhile, you know, these girls that are there working are kind of coming over and trying to figure out what's going on. They are very interested in Ron because, you know, on some level, Ron is a man who can get them out of Sacramento, which I wanted to be out of Sacramento at that time. I would have done anything Ron Jeremy said to get the fuck out of Sacramento. So they kind of come over and try to size up the situation. They see us talking to him. They look at us and go like, well, I imagine they're thinking like, well, these guys are not in the business. They're not making movies.
Yeah.
They must be the producers. They must be the one making. They must be the money men, or something like that. So, like one by one, like they kind of come back, going, "Hey, what's up, guys? Hey, how's it going?" And this was a pretty long time ago. So this will make more sense with that in mind. Like, you know, we're just kind of making small talk, and it's like, "So, how's business? How's it going? And
how are dollars flowing?
Hey,
tonight,
how's things going?" And you know, this one girl's like, "Well, you know, I'm doing really well lately because, you know," points at her face like this and goes, "No doubt." And we're both sitting there like for a couple seconds, and we both instantly come to the realization like, oh, she thinks that she looks like Gwen Stefani.
Yeah.
Who was very big at the time.
How far off was she from that assessment?
Not even close. So both of us just go, "Oh, of course, yes. I mean, look at you. Yeah, I mean,
spiderwebs.
You're raking it in. Yeah, just a girl. Of course, this is huge. This is amazing. Yeah, you're doing really well.
They all think
great.
It's you. They all think it's you."
I had to get out of there so bad. Like, so that was, you know, we eventually kind of got out of there, sat in the strip club, watched Ron's stand-up act, which really bummed me out. In a ton of ways.
That sounds really depressing.
Yeah, it was. I mean,
this story was a lot more depressing than I thought it was going to be when I asked you to tell it to our audience. I think you are audience. An apology.
That's the real lesson about the porn industry. I think is
it's super depressing.
It's way more depressing than it seems.
I've always imagined.
And yeah, that was That was a dark time. So wrestling reminds me a lot of my time with Ron Jeremy.
Because they're still grasping at those straws.
Yeah, because there's that thing of like, you know, they'll come back in from commercial break, and this stuff I think I've said on our podcast a little bit, but like, they'll come back in from commercial break and say things like, did you know that Raw was the number one most watched program in the world last week? It's like, no one watching cares. That's just them going like, trying to convince people like, no, you're doing the cool thing. Everyone's watching Raw. You're real. Like, did you know that we've got Jon Stewart in the audience of this pay-per-view? Like, no one cares.
They've been doing that forever. And I mean, like, you remember when they did like the one where they used to do the it was Goldust TV in the end or whatever, but GTV, remember? And they had like the cast of Mystery Men back there, and it was just like, what the heck? Yeah. What are you doing? Gene Garofalo? Yeah. Ben Stiller, they were all back there.
Huge wrestling fans,
yeah,
I'm sure.
Big time.
Gene Garofalo especially.
But yeah, I mean, that's wrestling story forever. And I think right now, you know, the big thing is like you wait for that next innovation. The fact to me, which is weird, when I come back and they still have that, the Attitude logo. They still have the WWE scribble lines. Yeah. And, you know, I mean, like that, I'm
so
ready.
So you got about 2 more months on that, I think. Yeah, and after they're finally going
to
switch it out.
Because they got to. It feels like it's got to be time. Because it's totally. Still, for me personally, it feels juvenile, right? Because I associate that with high school. Yeah. I wore ties with that to school with that on the tie. You know what I mean?
Like, of course, that's very cool.
Hey, when you went to Catholic school.
Did you tie all right. Yeah, when you had to wear a tie, and that was the only thing that could.
Did you tie that around a Hawaiian shirt?
No, that's why I couldn't. That's why I did not address myself.
Oh, my God. This makes so much sense.
But. I hear what you're. This so what, I think sense. One of the things that bonds wrestling fans together is bitching about wrestling, though, right?
Totally, and that's the thing that I think applies to, you know, whether it's like video games or just like comic books and movies and all that other stuff. Like, there's just a contingent of people that, you know, seem to live to complain about.
Yeah,
but isn't that like all sports in general?
I guess so.
Too?
I guess so. It's like any passion. Maybe it is. Just at some point, it's any passion exists solely for people to get together around that. Thing they love
and bitch about.
And bitch about.
It goes back to what we always talk about with comments on articles and videos, right? Like, there's always these negative comments on something because that's what motivates people to say something. That they don't like it, right?
Right, yeah. Like, when you just say, get a lot of people. I mean, we get a fair amount of that, but you know, it can be mixed sometimes.
Sure,
but by and large, it
all depends on the community you build. Beyond Up at Noon, this show, these people know that we'll be there talking to them. But when they feel like it's just them talking, I feel like that's when it's quicker to be like, man, this sucked. I hate this.
Also, don't you guys get the feeling that a lot of people prefer to think in sort of binary terms? It's either great or horrible. Like you started this whole thing off by saying like, people are extreme right now. It's everything's either fantastic or not. But like. With everything being so fast and as fast as it is, especially on the internet,
right?
Isn't it just easier to like make that snap decision about something?
Sure. It's
like,
one of the things I think
I hate or love soccer,
right?
Like Greg loves soccer,
of course.
Like,
I mean, who doesn't?
Bummed Everyone. Out right now, super bummed out right now. Yeah. The USA
I was
lost
on cloud
today.
Fucking nine. When they lost
like
today.
Finally, these people will shut the fuck up.
I'm like, it'll be back to my Twitter feed. Will just be Gary Whitta and Colin Campbell and Darren Brazil talking about soccer, which I can
and
live
then
with.
Everyone else, you're just like, all right.
I'm at a bar and this soccer's better than I thought it was. Man, go USA.
I'm going to give this soccer a chance from now on.
You mess with one of us, you mess with all of us.
Help Spider-Man.
That's Spider-Man. You know my New York impression. Yeah, go Spider-Man. I'll swing all these cranes over the street for you. We're all working at 9 o'clock on this one. Come on, guys. It's New York.
Radio. It's connected to all the crane operators in New York. This is the best thing on the planet.
I think, you know, one of the side effects, I mean, people have obviously always been pretty binary on that stuff, but stuff like Twitter and, comment fields and stuff just makes it so much easier. I mean, Twitter, I mean, the limitations there don't allow for nuance most of the time, so it's just like, fuck this, or this is great, fuck everyone else.
Yeah.
You know? And I don't know, I feel like that's has to be the thing that, you know, is going to keep people away from a lot of those like those services and is going to kind of make them stagnant over time if they aren't already. Like I feel like I'm already like slightly tired of Twitter.
How dare you?
Yeah, it's, you know, it's all about moderation, right?
Yeah,
with that kind of stuff.
See, I'm relatively new to Twitter. Follow Nick at Nick _ Scarpino.
It's
on
the screen the entire time. I guess you have to say it for the MP3 people.
I'm new to it. I'm still addicted to it. Yeah. I'll be 100%. But you guys have been on it forever. You guys have like hundreds of thousands of followers. You're like the Ron Jeremy of Twitter. Right now, basically.
Falling asleep mid-conversation, waking up and going like, let me tell you about something that happened to me 20 years ago.
But, I don't know. I still like it. I like that at least on Twitter you do have to think a little bit if you want to say something halfway deep, you know?
Yeah. Like, it sharpens up a little bit of thought. Like, you're kind of one-liner. Like, muscle gets a little sharper.
Or you do the parentheses, 1-15. Yeah. You're like, oh, okay, here we go.
You're like, So that's why I ended up signing up for a Tumblr account at some point.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Because they have a means for people to ask me questions. And then also, if I have something more to say, it's sure. Like, and it's a little bit smaller. You know, mm-hmm. It's like I don't have as many followers there. So it's like it's a little tighter knit.
Yeah.
And you can kind of just have some conversations.
We've talked about Internet of Hate a lot. And I think this flows into it in a way. But we are, I think, way quick. I think there's so much vying for attention right now, too, is the other thing, right? We have to talk about this with especially Netflix, right, Nick? Where we start something and if it doesn't grab us in the first 5 minutes, right? It's like, well, fuck this movie, I'm out.
Yeah, whereas attention spans and the number of choices that people have, like, yeah, why would you settle for mediocre entertainment? Yet, I can't fucking stop watching wrestling.
See, I fell back in the wrestling hole kind of when they did the network.
Yeah, that was amazing. Like, I feel like that's awesome because then you can go back.
WWE Network.
It's every pay-per-view they've ever run over the 30 years. So it's like you can go back and watch all that old stuff and all the stuff you missed in between. They have a lot of documentaries that are like
the documentaries
super interesting.
This is what happened to me is I got the network. I'm like, whatever, it's trial. And of course, I forgot to cancel. So now I'm signed up for 6 months.
Yeah.
So I'm watching it here and there. We watched WrestleMania and stuff. But then Christine, my girlfriend, watched WrestleMania for a little bit. She's like, oh, this is weird. But then like it was like you, right? Like you're like, this sucks, but I can't stop watching.
We watched WrestleMania. I haven't watched WrestleMania since, I don't know, it was like 10.
Sure.
And I watch. I don't know who any of these guys are because I like the campy old wrestling with like, you know, Million Dollar Man and
it's kind of getting back to some of those characters.
I feel like it's all just dudes right now. You know what I mean? Like, and then when they had the Royal Rumble kind of thing, whatever, like where everyone's fighting, that was like where all the throwaway G.I. Joe bad guy characters were.
Yeah.
But yeah, I was like, I'm gonna watch this for 10 minutes, and then I sat there for like 4 hours.
I can't stop watching.
The dark thing about that stuff is, as someone who used to occasionally buy a pay-per-view before they launched the network, like now my tolerance is just like it's super high because those shows were $60 a piece for 3 hours.
Yeah, so you're getting like this great deal.
And now it's $10 a month. So like when a pay-per-view sucks, I'm like, whatever, it was like free.
Yeah.
Like I paid like $0 for it. Like I just sat there for 3 hours and ate frozen yogurt and
Portilla, come here away from the wires that control the camera and podcast.
Just chew through the wires. Party. Yeah, so it's like the dark thing is like now my bar is way lower for...
But that's all, I mean, like Greg was saying, that's all of us, right? Like the other day I started watching Voyager, and first of all, I don't know if it's as good as Deep Space Nine. I haven't started watching that yet, but you guys tell me on Twitter. And I ended up skipping whole seasons of it. Mm-hmm. But I was like, it's not very good. I just want to see how the season ends. Oh, wait, I can. Skip to the season end, watch the season from like the beginning of the next one.
Right, yeah.
Now, I mean, I've gone through that and, you know.
You have no idea what the hell's going on, but you watch
it. I have no idea what's going on, but they're almost back to Earth.
Get into that weird habit that people get into where they just watch the first episodes and last episodes of something.
Oh, I'm about there.
Yeah.
I'm actually going to go back and watch The Next Generation, just the last like 3 episodes.
Sure, yeah.
Just because I can't remember how that series ends. And Netflix is in that weird place where it doesn't have a large value to most people.
Yeah, I canceled mine.
Did you?
Wow. Yeah.
Really?
I was in LA. I was in a hotel room, and I had a desperate need to watch Tokyo Drift. It was not on Netflix. I said, fuck you, Netflix. It's right there.
First of all, let me commend you on your choices in life, because Tokyo Drift is wildly believed to have brought the series back. Because it's the third one.
Yeah, the second one was
abysmal.
Garbage.
Thank you. Yeah. We can all agree that's the worst Fast and Furious. Yeah.
I have a framed Tokyo Drift poster at home.
Oh, it's so good.
Yeah, it's an amazing
kindred
film.
Nick.
Yeah, now that we're wading into this topic, I'm sure Tim just woke up in Austin screaming because he's not here to stop you.
Yeah, because Tim swears that the second movie is not the worst, but it is the worst.
What is then? Are you saying four or five? He thinks four is the worst.
It's the one where they go through
the drug tunnels, right? Yeah. But it's they're driving fast cars through drug tunnels.
Tim?
You suck, Tim.
Drug tunnels.
You don't suck, Tim.
Here's the thing about wrestling. Christine watched a little bit of it, was interested enough. We had Jericho on up at noon. We started watching the documentaries, and then we tumbled down a hole.
Yeah.
Because when you're going through the documentaries, for me, I'm like, oh, yeah, like the DX, oh, yeah, the Madison, you know, the Click and the Madison Square Garden and all, this is great. And then she's like, this is just fascinating. Because, like, what I love about wrestling, why I read the wrestling wrap-up on IGN, why I still check Raja once in a while, right, is that I just want to know what's going on backstage more than anything.
Totally,
right?
Yeah.
I always feel like...
Who are they signing? Who's injured? Like, who got caught shoplifting?
Yeah, exactly. You can always, like, once you know wrestling, you can always be plucked out and put back in without any... Oh, who's Undertaker feuding with? Great. What happened?
You need 1 week to catch up and go, like, okay, yeah.
Yeah, I'm caught.
None of this is that complicated. Yeah, so it's, like, a nice, like, casual thing to watch, because it sort of doesn't matter. And it never ends. So there's no season cliffhanger. There's no, like, I don't watch Game of Thrones. Who has time for that?
I do.
Wrestling's on.
See, and this is the thing, that this is what you're talking about too. I think there's a problem with it, is that since it never ends, there's no, you know, you have to have a new storyline every week, every 2 days, really.
Right, yeah.
And so then you're always like, well, I'll see what's going on. Because it's easy to pop back into. It's like video games, right? Mm-hmm. There's so many times I want to start a new game, but I'm like, I don't have enough time to invest in this right now.
Totally.
But I'll put back in Skyrim or whatever, yeah. DC Universe Online. I know that.
That's me with Wolfenstein. Like, I really want to play it. And it's like one of those things where it's like, I know I need a chunk of time. Mm-hmm. And instead, I spent that same chunk of time playing like 8 different smaller games just so I didn't have to commit to playing Wolfenstein all the way through yet.
Okay.
And yeah, that's
so wrestling is just like a video game you've started and you know.
Yeah, and it's just like I just play it. And just, you know,
do you think you'll ever quit?
I mean, I quit for years and but then kind of fell back in and fell out and fell back in. Yeah. And I mean, the real answer is at this point, we are now doing a monthly wrestling podcast.
So, nope.
So
thanks a lot, Dan.
Now I've got a business reason.
Yeah.
To business.
Yeah, it's good. Business reason. Now you get to write off the WWE Network.
Exactly.
But there I will say this just generally about the hate and how hate is attracted to. Well, people, haters are attracted to everything, right? Like, you can't kind of escape it, the binary nature of zeros or tens and loving or hating something. Greg, I like politics.
Right? I know you
do.
This
is a very, very political thing, like loving and hating and evil and good. But I think back to, you know, the founders and the Constitution, when they wrote it and when they were kind of all partying together after they won the revolution in 1783.
Yeah, they hit that hard.
Articles of Confederation and then the Constitution. They didn't anticipate political parties and, in fact, tried to warn against them. And immediately they fractured and had political parties within like 1 year after the Constitution, like official, you know, Federalists and Anti-Federalists. And the broadsheets back then were like horrific, like much worse than the newspapers and news. Like, sure, we make fun of like MSNBC today, but like the newspapers back then were insane, like what they were saying about people and stuff like that. And so the hating is timeless and it's everywhere. It's like, did you know Alexander Hamilton fucked his mom? Like, there was, you know, it's like like crazy ass, you know, not literally that, but like crazy ass.
I'll vote for that guy.
Yeah. So, you know,
like, keep it in the family.
He won over a sect of the population.
Yeah,
like,
check.
It's been there, brother. All right.
he could run for president. Wasn't born in the United States, but that was his big mistake. Was not his being born in the United States. he was born in the Caribbean. But I just feel like it's everywhere. Like, it just touches everything, and it kind of sucks. And I've been trying to be better about what we talk about. I'm a huge Jets fan, so when football happens, I would always make fun of Mark Sanchez, especially after like 2009 and 2010. He started like really crumbling, and then I was like, you know, I'd be like, you know, he'd throw an interception. I'd be like, Mark Sanchez fucking sucks, you know, on Twitter or whatever. Like, what? Like, what's with this guy? Bench him. And then I'm like, is that really necessary to say that? You know, like, what? First of all, what if he like reads that? Is that hurt his feelings? Like, I don't like when people are mean to me on Twitter. And then I had that same instinct today. Like, with the hockey free agency started, I'm a big Islanders fan. So I originally wrote my tweet out. And I'm like, I'm gonna keep a close eye on Twitter today to see how badly Garth Snow, is the GM, fucks everything up. That's what I wrote. And then I'm like, that's mean. So then I just erased it and I said the New York Islanders, because then it's at least a group of people.
that was after that last wrestling pay-per-view. All I did was get on Twitter and just type WRESTLING! !
It's like, almost as if someone were like, I mean, I can kind of understand a little bit, but I don't know what would drive a man to like rant for 15 minutes straight about how much he hates like a sport.
And so you're being like the Twitter kids and the comment kids. You're misrepresenting the argument. It wasn't that I hated the sport. It's the Fairweather fans for the World Cup that popped up out of nowhere that I know.
Well, I was one of them today.
The sport isn't worth it.
You weren't tweeting your balls off about it.
I legitimately got in that game and I sat down and I came over to give you the score.
I mean, the sport isn't even worth hating. It's worth completely ignoring. It's just like, why pay any attention to it?
It's everywhere. You couldn't get away from it.
It's for brigands and hobos. It's like...
Now it's over. You should have seen the comments were the fucking best on that video that we did for the World Cup.
I'm gonna go back and look.
Yeah. It's so good, dude. Because my favorite thing, and I tweeted about this. I don't know how you guys feel about this. I thought it was funny. I got retweeted like hundreds of times. I was saying like, guys are like fucking twat Americans with your arrogance, you fucking assholes. Like all this kind of stuff, whatever. And I'm like, they're so full of themselves, they're fucking worthless. Like all this kind of shit. I'm like, you're on YouTube. It's an American website. Like, we made that. Are you on your? Are you typing it from your iPhone? And then are you going to go check Twitter and play Xbox? And then watch your American movies and your American TV shows and listen to your American music and all that. I was like, relax a little bit. Like, all right, we have like a bad reputation around you, but you're still replicating everything.
No,
we do.
They're going to go play ZX Spectrum games.
It's like, relax. What's the, why so personal?
It wasn't even against soccer. It wasn't even that soccer.
Well, because Tim named it why the World Cup completely sucks, which is probably a good. It's a good title to get people to click on.
We definitely got a lot of clicks.
Yeah,
but
that was clickbait. That was you guys clickbait. Are nightmares for that sort of thing. But yeah, that's absolutely.
We have good.
We're
gonna
name
too.
This. We're gonna name this one like you know.
Why I can't quit wrestling?
Halle Berry naked. This is gonna be that episode. Look at Halle Berry naked.
In jorts.
To put a pin in it.
Halle Berry.
Call it Halle Berry naked, and then in parentheses, not swordfish. Because every time I click on that, it's always just that same thing.
Yeah, it's a good thing.
Wrestling's junk food, and it's comfort food.
Totally.
You go back to it. It's you know what you're getting into.
And yeah, and I don't have to pay close attention to it. It can just be on, and I can do something else with my time.
Thank God, Ross, 3 hours.
Yeah. Right.
Colin.
Yes.
What do you got for a topic?
So we did a conversation with Colin, the acclaimed Emmy Award winning show.
Yes.
Daytime Emmys.
Broke-ass Emmy Award. We did a conversation with Colin about Kickstarter a long time ago, and I've been very vocal about my disliking of Kickstarter for years.
You're a big non-Kickstarter.
And by the way, just to answer the questions, because people ask this all the time, we are going to bring conversation with Colin back for one more season. We promise. It'll happen later this summer.
Coming back. We should head to the World Cup.
We appreciate that you want it back so much. Why you want it back, I don't know.
Because they don't want to hear Nick or Tim.
Yeah, that's a good point. That's a good point. You want to hear me?
Fair enough.
Vote for me for president.
Districtlines.com/GameOverGreggy. There's also that team fat shirt.
It feels like love.
So fundamentally, I'm still against Kickstarter for the same reasons I've always been against Kickstarter. That I think it's somewhat predatory in the sense that... especially with big companies like Harmonix did it recently, or when Double Fine did it, when they're like these companies with means, big games under their belt, publisher connections, and probably quite a bit of money in the bank, go, we don't really believe in this product enough to use our own money, so we're going to go to the masses to get the money ahead of time to make a game like they were doing with Amplitude, or like, you know, Double Fine did with their games. A lot of people did about Obsidian, whoever.
Yeah.
But I've been kind of coming around on it a little bit, not in the sense that I still think it's right or wrong. I still think that big publishers, big names really have no right to do it, whether it's in movies or music. I just think it's kind of fucked up and wrong. Like it pushes out the little guy, it takes attention away from the little guy that really needs the funds. But just in the sense that we've been getting some good stuff from it. And you can't deny that, you know, and I always talk about intellectual honesty and how, and challenging yourself and not being rigid in the way you feel. And that's kind of a lost art with a lot of people.
So wait, what brought those around? Just which
Shovel Knight was the one that brought
them. Okay. Shovel Knight.
Now people were really confused because I exclusively revealed Shovel Knight on IGN back before it was announced.
Suck it, Giant Bomb.
Oh, well, damn.
But, oh, what up? What up? East side, west side.
Oh, but I bring that, shit. But I bring that up because people are like, well, you hate Kickstarter, so why would you do that? And I'm like, because I'm trying not to be biased. Like it's still a game and still people, I think game, care, you know, going to care about it, and I want to cover it. I think it's really interesting. But, you know, I have a good relationship with those guys, and, you know, they sent us the game, and I really liked it and stuff like that. And I'm like, you know, the fact of the matter is this game is unpublishable, you know, and I don't think that, like, a real publisher would back it. Now, maybe they could have found some venture capital or something. I think that a smart person would
self-publish.
Yeah, exactly. So they asked for $60,000. They ended up getting, like, $300,000. And it ended up being a great game. I think it's the best game of the year. And, you know, I still think the other great games, Child of Light, South Park, whatever, Danganronpa, these are all great games. But this is really my favorite game of the year. And I started to kind of think back, and I'm like, you know what? There is a method to the madness with Kickstarter in terms of the products gotten. Now, I still think that the model of taking money ahead of time as a pre-order and then making profits off of that money without any risk is really fundamentally messed up. But... for smaller guys that like to do Kickstarter that don't have those means or those connections, or whatever, it does give us some good products. So I really kind of want to just talk to people and talk to you guys. It's one of those intellectual honesty moments, kind of one of those moments, those come to Jesus moments where you're like, man, maybe I was wrong. You know?
Hashtag Colin was wrong?
I know the hashtag usually Colin was right.
I've had that reaction. Sorry to interrupt you.
No, I'm just talking about my Rezogun. Colin was right hashtag because everyone made fun of me for fucking 6 months. I come back from Gamescom like, this is PS4's best game. Everyone's like, you're an asshole.
Everyone. Look
at, yeah, it's like, no, guys.
Four people in the comments, a few on Twitter.
No, people were harsh about that.
Were they all just like, what about Knack?
Yeah. They were like, this downloadable game. Mark Cerny
wouldn't come out of retirement for exactly.
And they were all, and then when it came out, everyone started hashtagging Colin was right, because Colin was right. But today, Colin was wrong, Nick.
So, I mean, I don't think you're, I don't hashtag think you're wrong. Maybe. I think that I see your perspective, and... from someone who, you know, has aspirations of funding giant projects one day, I'd love to make a film one day. And I look at guys like Kevin Smith, who use these crowd sharing platforms to jumpstart things that, or, you know, are the producers of Veronica Mars, who, you know, you were on TV. And so it's very difficult to look at that and go, I don't understand why you can't just call up your network buddies and get a check cut for that and go shoot the movie. And then you start reading a little bit more about it, and it is true. It's very difficult to get anything funded, no matter who you are these days.
Especially something like that, that like you look at it and you're like, this wouldn't be a good risk for someone with money to take. Like, it has to be that passion thing. It has to be the fans stepping
up.
And we always used to say, you know, I feel like there have been people over the years, plenty of people that would say, like, oh, man, if only they would make a sequel to this, I would pay $200 for that. Mm-hmm. And Kickstarter is the thing that lets those people put their money where their mouth is.
Yeah.
And I had a real problem with it for a long time, too. And my problem was one of, like, who is vetting these companies? Who's vetting these people? Like, what's the risk involved that these people could just take the money and run away? And it was one of those things where, like, as someone who, you know, kind of talks about things before that, like, I was very hesitant to talk about active Kickstarters. Like, I still am to some extent because, you know, like, I don't want to be the guy that says, hey, look at this, you should put your money on this, and then they run off with the money.
Right.
You know, and I bought a Pebble watch. It's terrible. The thing's garbage. It's a piece of trash. It's a flimsy, it's an awful thing.
But see, I think, I mean, from my perspective, it's too hard to get good ideas funded in this day and age through traditional means. I firmly believe that. In the movies, I can't really speak to video games, but in movies, everything is either a sequel or a pre-existing property that just rebooted.
Well, that's what video games are too, yeah.
And it's because it is as safe of a bet as it can be, mm-hmm. right? But finally, there is that third option for the investors. And I kind of disagree a little bit in that there's not really any risk on either sides if you think about it, and that's the beauty of Kickstarter or these crowdfunding sources, is that I'm only giving you a dollar, and I don't know too many people that can't give a dollar, right? It's not a risk if that project never comes.
Game over, go get up, bandcamp.com.
Yeah, exactly. But I'm willing to take that sort of like, okay, I'm going to give this guy this to and see what he's worth and see if he can actually come through. I heard a fascinating interview with the CEO of Kickstarter. He was saying, they asked him that. They were like, what happens if someone takes the money and goes? And he goes, we haven't had it happen yet. And if they did, then their name would be ruined forever, and there's nothing that they can't really come back from that. There's nothing worse than your name ruined forever in business if you were to do that.
Yeah.
And then they actually said if it were to a certain point where it was a lot of money, they'd probably go after legal means of getting the money back and putting the person in jail. Which I was like, that kind of makes that makes me feel a little bit better.
I just wonder, like, legally, what leg would they have to stand on to try to prosecute someone? Because the whole thing is like, this is not a pre-order. You're funding a thing. Like, there are risks involved.
Right. And there have been people that I've heard of that have abused Kickstarter.
Right. Oh yeah, a lot of people
they've gotten
shit fails,
tens of thousands of dollars, and then put like $1,000 into their project, and like, voila, here I am. But for every one of those, I mean, you have hundreds of success stories, which I think, you know, no system is perfect. Every system is imperfect.
For me, it was meeting Max Temkin from Cards Against Humanity.
Oh,
they kickstarted that originally, and it was the sort of thing where they were approaching it in a very open way. They were like, you know, look, you can just print these cards out if you want. Like, we'll put them all out, Creative Commons, all the other stuff. But like, if we'll print this like nice package and this boxed version, and if you want to get that from us, we will sell it. And it always felt like they were approaching that from a place of honesty and providing alternatives and stuff like that. It's like, you know, and I think it's worked out really well for them. And they've been huge proponents of Kickstarter since, kind of advocates for other people that are using the platform, even though they obviously no longer really need it. And, you know, talking to them kind of about their story and kind of how they use the platform, like, it kind of turned me around on it a little bit for things of that size, for, you know, these people that are approaching things like, you know, this is a thing we really want to make, and, you know, like, we don't have the capital to make it ourselves, and it's kind of it's a risky business idea that, you know, has no lifespan past this one thing. You know, you're not going to go invest in this and then what's project two, what's project three. I think, you know, for the cards guys, obviously they have a lasting business, but, you know, by and large, if someone's out there like, I want to make a hoodie that when you zip it up you can still see,
genius.
So I got one of those coming in October.
You're gonna rob every bank with it.
Exactly. It's gonna be beautiful. You know, it's those types of projects that are just like, what, you know, what's the lasting business model on that? You're gonna get into the clothing business and like make a second one and make a third one, like maybe. But maybe it's just a one-off thing. And for me, that's the stuff that makes me kind of a believer in the platform. Like games and the bigger projects and stuff like that, I definitely feel a little weird about.
It depends on who it's coming from, though, right? Like, if it's someone, it's two dudes in their basement in like Ohio,
exactly, yeah,
and they're like, we got this great idea, we want to see it come to life, can you help us? I think there's something really pure and really awesome in that. The other thing I hear all the time that I read about, especially, you know, with movies, is that you hear about a movie bombing, right? A movie that's supposed to be really popular. Maybe it's based on a popular franchise, but it's a big studio film and it bombs. And no one will ever come out right and say why it happened, because no, everyone wants to work in Hollywood again. But it's usually a commonly upheld notion that it bombed because there were too many chefs in the kitchen. There were too many studio heads. There were too many executives. There were too many people who could tell you.
To death or something.
Yeah, or it got focused tested to death. And there's too many people to water down the purity of the creativity. And that's what excites me about Kickstarter, is that you can go on, and if you have a big enough fan base that loves you, they'll give you something, and then they go, we just want to see what you do with it. Just you. And there's a ton of pressure in that, but there's also something awesome if you can come through for your
fans.
There's
something pure, right?
It's very pure.
You have a vision, you go and deliver.
And it's not like 80 people telling me that there's got to be a giant spider at the end of my Superman movie. I can just make my Superman movie.
And that's why I started to feel a little bit better about some of the larger studios doing game projects on there. It was that idea of just like, you know, I think we all know deep down that, like, you know, Double Fine, they were not doing outstanding
when
they did Kickstarter. It was not, you know, that was like a Hail Mary for them. I don't think they were expecting to even get that much money. Like, it was weird at the time. But, you know, I think that they've done all right by their backers and generally a few bumps along the way. And, like, the Harmonix thing, like, making an Amplitude game is bad business. That's a dumb idea. It's a sequel I would love to see made. But, like, if you kind of step back and look at it, and look at, like, the Rockman game they did that was basically an Amplitude
Blitz
game.
Or whatever.
Yeah, Blitz. Yeah. Like, this is not a sound business move. And they say they're putting in a bunch of their own money to it. I mean, you know, we're not looking at the books for it or whatever.
Yeah, oh, but we know? Will.
Yeah, exactly.
Someone
will find those books and look through them.
Yeah. That's the point, is the mitigation of risk was one of my major issues. Sure. Just because I'm like, if you... Yeah, you can't always find capital, right? You can't find...
It's very difficult.
In gaming world, you can't find, you know, venture capital or publishing, and same in the movie industry and stuff like that. I had more of an issue saying, like, my whole approach to it in the beginning was like, all right, like, a company, Obsidian, needs $500,000 to make their whatever fucking RPG. And the model should have been like, hey, we need 20 investors at $25,000 a piece, you know?
Sure.
And you will get all of your money back when we make the game, like, and we sell it. Like, you'll be paid back, and then you'll each own 5% equity in the game, sure, or whatever. Like, make it a risk reward kind of thing, because there's stuff out there that I would like. Mighty No. 9. If like they were like, you can actually own like equity in the game, I'd be like, this game's gonna be huge. You know, like, yeah, for old school nerds, that game's gonna be big, and they only need $1 million or whatever, and you give them $15,000, and you own a little piece of that. I'm like, fuck yeah. Like, and sure, then get like a little bit of return. Obviously, we wouldn't have been able to cover the game. Would have been a very complicated kind of thing. All like for our, you know, for our, sure, our day jobs, that you have to kind of take all that into consideration.
Right.
Also,
yeah,
also,
you'd have been like, screw it.
No, I mean, I'm doing it. Ethics is really important. I mean, you have
everybody
to like.
Everybody already thinks he's too biased on Mega Man.
how much stock do you own in video game companies?
I own all the stock.
Billions. Activision. That's Moriarty spelled.
The only time I ever thought about buying stock, and then we would have to. I probably might not even been allowed. It was when THQ was bombing, which was not a good idea. But at the time, when it was like $1.10, $1.20, I was like,
it's worth more than that.
Yeah, I was like, this company's going to come back, and if you buy THQ at $1 and they go back to $10 or $15, like, you're rich.
Yeah,
you know, like, like, you're making
I'm glad you didn't sink your entire life savings.
Yeah, no, I was. That was the only time I ever thought
about it. Jason talked a lot of it.
Yeah, right. Just stopped your hand.
Yeah, Homefront 2 is really going to turn them around.
No, I mean, I'm with you. Like, I like Kickstarter for... I mean, I don't mind anyone using it, but the ones I get behind are the little guys and these little ideas. Like, did you back the history of video game wrestling?
No, I backed a really good-looking, like, Sega coffee table book.
Right, all this stuff that, like, no one's going to make that.
That's what I'm talking about, is you guys, you can back that one, like... It's really hard to get funding, like, to Colin's point, but it's easier to get funding when you've already done something small that is a hit, and then you want to make your next project just slightly bigger. And that's what a lot of these guys do, is they come in and they say, you know, there's the old rule in, like, independent filmmaking, you want to make $1 million movie, make a $250,000 movie that is successful. And then by virtue of that, you want to make 250, make 100,000, make 50,000. So start small and build on that. And if you have the stuff that it takes to knock it out of the park and make something that's actually successful, well, then that's what we should be looking for,
yeah,
right?
Grow,
we should be looking for these people
absolutely
that can grow and grow with our audience. You know, having said that, I've got I'm going to be making a Greg Miller sex doll that's going to go on
districtlines.com/gameover.
Yeah. So if anyone wants to crowdfund that, I only need $10.
Why are you? We can sell it on the store. We have a store. We don't need to crowdfund it.
Just get a big life size Sackboy costume.
Okay. Thank you. Never mind, guys. It's closed. Kickstarter's closed. Goal reached. That's how Kickstarter works, right?
You use burlap.
Wait, what are my rewards?
You have to actually. You get to come to where they do the plaster cast on me.
Oh,
jeez.
They're going to cast his buttocks first.
I've really fucked this up.
I'm giving this back.
All right.
Until you rethink that.
Finally, I got a refund.
So, yeah, I just wanted to kind of throw that out there just in the spirit of intellectual honesty, just to say I've been thinking about it again. I had really rigid ideas about Kickstarter that are still somewhat there, but for the smaller guy, especially even our friends at the Comedy Button, when they Kickstarted their podcast, it's not like they're, you know, it's not like a for-profit venture. It wasn't designed to be that way. It was like, we're going to do a year's worth of this silly podcast for you, and we need to fund it. That kind of stuff makes more sense to me than, you know, even Double Fine, like we were saying, like, yeah, they're not flush with cash, but they do have connections. They might have been able to make it work or use their own money. There are rich people that work at that company. If they really believe in the product, then you kind of put the money behind it, just like a lot of people used to do, you know? And still do. They still do that every day. So yeah, I just wanted to throw that out there because I know it's not a contentious point really with our people, but it's a point that comes up a lot, whether it's on Podcast Beyond or this show or a conversation with Colin. And I want to say I'm kind of rethinking it. I'm open. My mind is malleable to being formed and reformed on.
I think that's really big of you, and I think that it's important too because I really don't think that crowdfunding is going to go away anytime soon.
Oh God, no! No.
I think it's going to be. Yeah. I'm hoping it turns
they'll
into
keep
something.
Bilking money out of people as long as they'll give it.
No. I mean, I've backed only a handful of projects on Kickstarter just because I don't have the time to actually research and sit there and fall in love with a project. Of the ones that I have backed, though, I think they all reached their funding goal, and I'm excited. I'm excited to see what they are. You know, it's just cool. It's an unprecedented era we live in. You know,
yeah, it's really definitely like I'm with you. Like I'm rethinking it a lot as well.
Good, you should
both from Kickstarter's just cool. like that end of it, and also just like.
Was it because of the Greg Miller sex doll? Is that why you're rethinking it?
Yeah.
Oh, it's gonna be so good, everyone. Life size.
Just that aspect of just like you know inches. How do we like as like journalists or whatever like cover that sort of stuff, like and not necessarily want to have influence on the you know it's like at one point I think Patrick ran a story about like a failing Kickstarter and he ran it while the Kickstarter was still going and they made the goal, so it's like that moment of just like.
Oops,
we did like, this.
That was awesome.
Is this on us? Yeah, and is that good or bad? You know, it's just like this moment of just like, what, you know, what are we really.
Yeah.
What are we really doing?
So. Yeah, that was. I rethought that, you know, in general. Like, we've had talks even at the site where I came up with the idea that was. You know, not received well or whatever. Not ill received, but just in the sense that they didn't want to do. Where I was like, maybe we shouldn't talk about Kickstarter games until they're funded, just so we don't act as a conduit by which we send. Like, it should be more organic than that.
Like, well, that was the thing.
But it's tough. Like because some of these are big deals. Like when
it's when very the newsworthy stuff.
Yeah, exactly. You know? When the Way Forward guys spin off to make another studio and make Shovel Knight or something like that. Like, that's somewhat newsworthy. You can't ignore that. So
there's that slippery slope.
It's tough.
Right? Yeah. In the beginning, it was. Just a game here, a game there, and then it became this deluge.
I think for us, it's, you know, it's trusting that the audience is smart enough to know what Kickstarter is, and that like we're not endorsing any of this stuff necessarily. Like, you know, this is something we may be personally interested in, and you know, personally think that it would love to see it go.
Yeah.
But we don't know if it's gonna be great or not.
All right.
Yeah,
well, I'm glad you're coming around, Colin. I like Kickstarter a lot. I like the fact that fans can support what they want. Like Amplitude.
Yeah.
Terrible business decision, but I wanted it, so I paid for it.
I ended up putting money into it, too.
Well, you knew people.
But
you're people who knew people.
But I put money into it anyway. I know those people. I was like...
You knew it was a ripoff from the get-go. You're like, whatever.
Talking to someone who wasn't going to be at the company in a little while about it.
Whatever. Drink. My turn.
Mm.
Mine.
Greg.
I want to hear some stories.
What's your topic? Yeah, I never get to say it. Can I say it? Greg. What's your topic?
Thank you, Nick. It's nice somebody to ask me finally. This week I want to talk about... I was thinking about this in the bathroom today. I walked into the bathroom, and I do the thing where I wash my hands before I'll touch my unit.
Okay.
When I've been shaking hands or walking around touching people. It's more of a cons. I was thinking about it today, though. I did the same thing. But when I'm at a convention, I don't get sick at conventions anymore because I know to wash my hands, never touch your eyes, never eat food, all these other things.
Yeah.
But this got me... It reminded me of when I was a kid... And I was kind of OCD. And right there is what I want to talk about. Mm. When I self-diagnosed myself as kind of OCD, which of course is an insult to anyone really suffering with OCD.
Yeah.
But I was like, as a kid, I was like, I'm kind of OCD.
Well, how did you do it when you were a kid when there's no internet?
Well, no, because you know what, I mean, you knew what obsessive compulsive disorder is. And, you know,
but
what,
everyone what, watched Double Dare and went like,
"Thank you."
But what would you obsess that it was? Because you didn't know what any what like you. So you see set like a rash on your arm.
No. This wasn't. I'm sorry. I wasn't worried about being sick when I was a kid wash my hands. When I was a kid, the problem was I couldn't sleep at night because I'd be afraid the garage door was open and someone's gonna steal our stuff. That. So I'd wake up. I wouldn't sleep. So I'd try to put it on my head. You roll over. You can't do it. Mm. I'd get up. I'd go downstairs. I'd unlock the door to the garage. Look in. See that it was there. Shut it. Lock the door. Go back up. And then I'd be like, did I leave the light on in the garage? Is that gonna burn the house down? I'd go back downstairs, unlock the door, looking there. I go back upstairs. Did I lock the door? And I go back down, I jiggle the handle, I'm like, did I just unlock? It's like this would go on all night long.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so I was like, I'm kind of OC. But then you get over it. You're just a dumb kid, probably.
Yeah, you kinda grow out of it and just go like, that's crazy talk.
Yeah.
Though to be fair, like some mornings I forget if I have closed my garage doors, I'm backing my car out.
Right.
And then have to turn around and go look. So I bought a security camera.
Nice. Do you check it on your phone?
I'm going to point it, yeah.
How long has that security camera been there?
About 3 days, so
okay.
Probably fine.
Okay, I'm okay.
What you did out in front of the house, no one saw that but me.
I like to sleep on your lawn.
Yeah, that's good, hot stuff.
I still do that kind of stuff. Like, every day before I leave the house, I'm the last one to leave. Cheryl leaves, Christine leaves, and then Greg leaves, and I'm usually the last one out. I'll still walk into the kitchen, make sure everything's unplugged.
Yeah, and you'll unplug it if it isn't.
Yeah.
God forbid I leave a toaster oven in my coffee maker.
My toaster oven almost burned my house down, so that's...
But it wasn't left on.
No, that's the scary part, is it wasn't on, but I came home, and it was just... So it beeps when it goes like, beep, beep, you know. I walked in the door, and it was just going, beep! I'm like, what is that? Toaster oven. And it unplugged, goes, beep! And I just now...
Wait, so it was just making noise?
But, you know,
it wasn't like smoking.
Yeah, who the fuck knows what was going on?
Who knows what was going on?
My favorite,
it could have been seconds away from bursting into flame.
My favorite is that Colin unplugs everything from the walls, including the Wii U gamepad. So on the rare occasion I want to turn that mother effer on, it's dead. I'm like,
I'm doing you a huge favor.
Saving you from yourself on that one.
Colin doesn't do that because he's OCD. Colin does it because he doesn't want to pay the power bill. That all those little
power... That's the other thing. When Scott Bromley lived here with me, I was so frugal about the power bill, like reducing the power bill, that we got 2 months free power paid for by PG&E because we reduced it... The prerequisite percentage month over month over month or something like that, where they were like, your shit's paid for. Like, you have a $150 credit or something like that.
That's
like,
amazing. Yeah. I love
that. Now we're like going through crazy. Everyone's leaving goddamn lights on everywhere.
No one's leaving it.
Look at this thing. That thing draws.
Yeah, I wonder what it really is, probably. Yeah.
I can just reach out, turn this off. If you think too much.
Yeah, we don't need
dark.
Zip. But,
do the rest of the
podcast. But I also obsessively check the stove and the oven before I leave. Mm-hmm. No one knows this because I'm the only one at home when this happens, but I go to like the, you know, we have a gas stove.
Is that why you leave late after everyone else? So you can do this?
Just no, because I would prefer not to be the last one out because then it's not my fault. You see, that's the way I rationalize it.
You're just trying to avoid the blame.
Yeah, exactly.
They pull that little like crispy wiener dog out of the fire. Mm-hmm. And they're like, who did this? You're like, wow. Not me. I washed my hands.
It was Greg's fucking dumbass leaving the host.
The Wii pad.
And then, yeah, so like it all says off and I'll go like off. And then I'll like lock there. Sometimes I come back in and check it again. But I always like shake the door when I lock it.
Yeah.
And yeah, it's just like certain things. My girlfriend makes fun of me. She knows my whole routine, so she'll be like, stop it.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
Just walk away. Just walk like when we're leaving the house.
Right.
Like, don't
right.
Check
right.
It.
Right.
I'm like, all right, but that doesn't help me. That just builds my anxiety.
Right. Yeah.
So how scared were you when literally the first week Mike Mitchell and I lived in this house. We both came home drunk, put a pizza in the oven, and passed out. And I woke up in the morning, and I was like, what the? Oh, no. And I ran over, and the oven was off, and there's just a charred disc in there. And I'm like, Mike, did you turn off the oven? He's like, no, we're all hungover. I'm like, oh, we're the worst people ever. Were you terrified? Are you going to burn the house down in a month?
I don't know. There must be some mechanism that shuts it off. I don't know. I didn't.
Oh, you didn't do it?
No, I don't remember. I mean,
it was a ghost.
I'm often drunk.
Our landlord came down.
Oh, did he?
No, I'm saying our landlord came out and turned off the
oven. I was
going to
say we owe him money. We should probably go pay him soon, too.
Okay, we'll finish this podcast.
I have two OCD things that I still do to this day. I always have to check my door to make sure it's locked.
Like I jiggle handles a lot.
I have to keep the keys in my hand with the key.
Mm.
And that's the thing that that reminds me as I leave the door. I'm like, oh, wait. If I have the key in my hand, that means I locked the door. Because otherwise I'll go back 3-4 times, which is the weirdest thing. I don't know why I do it. I know I locked it.
But
sometimes it's because I go back, and as I go back, I start daydreaming about stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And then I find myself on my stairs again. I'm like, did I even lock it? Or did I just walk up to the door, try the handle, and then it doesn't matter? And I'm also really weird about parking. Like, I cannot keep my car parked unless it's like 6 inches away from the curb. If it's any farther than that, I will continue to repark it. And in San Francisco, by the way, sure, yeah. This is a pain in the ass. Yeah. This is not like parking at a Costco.
Yeah.
My wife has now learned she gets out of the car and just keeps walking. Like wherever we're going to go, she's just like, I'll see you there because this could take
I would think that she would help you get closer to the curb. She tried sure it you're first. Not hitting it too much.
Yeah, I had to park like perfectly in between. Like, you know, if there's two driveways, I have to be equidistant between like each driveway. Yeah. It's a whole thing. She's washed her hands of it. She doesn't want anything to do with me. She wouldn't even get in the car most of the time unless I'm like taking her someplace. It's trippy.
So let me just ask, what the question, Greg was OCD?
What or you, just self-diagnosis? What is one of these goofy diagnoses you've just given yourself you've never actually tested? I always talk about I'm hard of hearing and I can't smell.
You are hard of hearing.
Well, it's true, but it's just like one of those things like how hard of hearing am I? I don't know.
Pretty hard of hearing.
Let me know if Colin ever does anything by my head.
Yeah, I mean, it's funny because I feel like it goes both ways. Like, you know, you're kind of crazy about that kind of stuff when you're younger. You think you're sick or everyone has those kind of things. You're going to die or whatever about, you know, some illness, some virus or disease that you've contracted. But then it went the other way for me after college. Like I developed, as you guys know, like I had a small bump on my nose. And yeah. I was like, I don't want to be vain. I was like, I'm not going to be vain. It's just what God gave me. And I was like, I'm not going to worry about it. I was there for a couple of years. And then finally went to the doctor and had it checked out. And they're like, oh, no, that's skin cancer. So I was like, oh, that's good.
Yeah.
So it went the exact other way where I was like, I wasn't diagnosing myself with anything. I was like, there's nothing to worry about.
Yeah.
Even when they cut it off, they're like, oh, we're just going to send it to the lab. It'll be fine. No big deal. Yeah. Here's the, you know, the way. But, and then they call me like, oh, no, that's kind of serious. You got to come back in. We got to cut your nose open. So I wish I did self-diagnose myself at that point. Mm-hmm. Of course, you know, I'm going to get a little perverted here, but
yeah,
when you first start having sex, mm-hmm. when you're younger, you self-diagnose
any day
yourself.
Now. Can't wait. Yeah. Very excited. I've heard so much about it.
I don't know about you guys, but I would self-diagnose myself like, you know, being totally protected, safe.
Oh, yeah.
And you'd be like, oh man, now I'm fucking gonna die. You know, I got this girl gave me this totally clean, nice girl gave me something, and I'm gonna die. Now
I have a friend that's just that used to do that to the extreme where it was he would have the biggest hang up about that. Like he would never go all the way with a girl. All the way up to like our mid-20s. And I was like, what? Why don't you want to do this? And he's like, because it wasn't even that he was afraid he was going to get anything. He's like, that's not what I'm afraid of. What I'm afraid of is that afterward, I always think that I got something with no cause whatsoever.
Sure.
And I'll just lament about it for like the next 6 months until I get to 10.
You wait for some anything.
Anything. Like, he's like, I'm constantly thinking like, oh my God, I got this thing.
I got it.
And I'm like, but you're going to know within a few days. And he's like, no. I've researched this. And he's like, you got to get tested like a month and then 6 months out and then a year out because you got to make sure you're clear for everything. And sometimes it doesn't show up until like a year out. Yeah. And I'm like, but that's just too much to think about. Like,
it's just worth it.
I'm like, be as safe as you possibly can and then enjoy. If you can't enjoy, then, you know, join a monastery.
Well, that's why he wasn't partaking because he couldn't enjoy.
True story. Not. He finally went all the way with somebody and got AIDS dead.
Damn!
Woo! Damn, that's the Game Over Greggy show.
That TLC
Thanks
song
for watching.
Was about him.
I was gonna say it was a collab of Waterfall and Alanis Morissette. Ironic.
Yeah.
What there was the Boston song in the 90s was about this.
The impression that I get.
Yeah, it was about the fear of getting like AIDS or
no, really? Yeah, I didn't know that.
Or like obsessing over the thought about it.
That happens to everybody, right? Like that's what you. I mean, when I became sexually active, like a nuclear warhead, that was always a concern, ago? Right?
Like a nuclear warhead.
Yeah.
Oh God, it's gonna go off.
I'm like, soon. I'm gonna get a horrible disease. Something's gonna happen. Blah blah blah.
I mean, just they just were shocking you into it. Like, that was the thing through the through the 80s and all that stuff. And just like there was, I mean, you know, I'm probably a little older than most of you guys, or all you guys. There's the just say no stuff, and then there's like, dude, don't have sex. You're going to get AIDS.
Yeah, yeah.
It's going to happen. Yeah. Not even get near drugs. They will kill you.
Here's but a photo of a totally disgusting penis that's like just destroyed with some STD.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that's the worst.
This is your penis on syphilis.
Yeah. The worst is
sizzling in a pan. You're like, oh, this is a weird commercial.
Can I go back to dinosaurs?
They tell you this, and it's really good advice. If you think you have any sort of disease, whether it be a sexually transmitted disease or just the normal run-of-the-mill diseases that might kill you, don't Google it.
Oh,
do not Google it.
Yeah, self-diagnosing on WebMD is the worst.
Go to your
doctor. I got a fever? Wait, I got a fucking fever?
Yeah,
it's a little red.
Oh my god, things that have fevers. The common cold.
Yeah, it's like
the Ebola virus.
Right. It's the worst.
Shit, it's got to be that second one. It's the one from Outbreak.
I really believe that the internet, internet's made a lot of things better. I think that the internet's made that worse.
Worse.
Sure.
Way worse. Although, having said that, you guys know I have this problems with doctors, right? Where I don't think they pay enough attention to you. I don't think they care about you. I think every time you go in there, the other day I went in to have my shoulder checked out, and he's a very nice doctor, but he's one of those doctors that's like training people. Mm-hmm. So he spent more time talking to them about me than me about what was wrong with my shoulder. And I had just gone through this terrible thing where I had to get a couple MRIs, and like I'm super claustrophobic, and I was super proud of myself for finally going through with the MRI because I was like able to center myself with some kung fu stuff. It was amazing. That's old school. I was able to actually get through it. And I was like, doc, I did this thing, and now we're going to finally figure out what's wrong with my shoulder. And he was in and out in 30 seconds. And I'm like, is that what they do? Like, do they just leave, Google it, come back, and be like, it's probably just this, and then they go on to the next patient and then drive their Porsche home to their golf car's house?
It all comes down to what you, I think, the doctor you have and what they're doing, right?
That's like every doctor, though. Like, I have one.
I've had a lot of good ones.
I lost a lot of faith in doctors. My dad spent about a year in the hospital, and, you know, at one point, basically, they were just like, well, you know, with some of this stuff, you know, you might, there's something to be said about quality of life. You might just want to go home.
I was
like, what the fuck are you, like, you know, and just, you know, just live it, just let it ride out until the end. I mean, he has made it home and all that stuff since. And so, but it was like that moment of just like, dude, this isn't, no one has led, this has not been made to sound this serious. So like him recovering from that and kind of making it out and just some of the other stuff that happened to him.
I had a lucky run when I got sick.
Yeah.
Like that, I had good doctors. Now I was the same thing as Colin, right? Like I went in there and I had these bumps on my neck forever and I was like, whatever. And they'll go away. There's a lymph node. And you go in there and it's like, yeah, I have this. And like, oh, and then, like when he felt him and his eyes lit up, I was like, oh fuck, this isn't like, I thought for sure you come in. I was like, oh,
I've got mumps simplex too.
Don't worry about this. Get out of here. You know what I mean? You always expect that, right? I was afraid I was wasting their time. Right. And then, they come in like flipped out. I was like, oh, okay.
See, I'm the opposite where I'm like, oh God, this is going to be something super serious. And then I never really know. Like, I still don't know what's going on with my shoulder. No idea. The guy's like, I guess we can do some cortisone shots. And I was like, isn't that what quarterbacks get in their shoulders? Yeah. Like, what do I do that's on the level of a freaking quarterback?
You carry the show.
Just the zebras. And the
chirons.
And you make the chirons.
I got to have the peak values set.
The peak values are essential to this podcast.
That's true. No, I don't know. I have one. My primary care physician is awesome. But when you go to the specialist, I really just don't think that. It's a crapshoot what you're going to get.
My cancer specialist is awesome.
Yeah, but I mean, for me, it's like my thing's not clearly not life-threatening, so why do they give a shit?
Your arm falls off as we talk.
It's like no one's going to get sued because at the end of the day, my arm just hurts.
Yeah, like I just need to go get checked out. It's been a while since I've been to a doctor.
I'll give you a physical.
Yeah.
All right,
cool. I'm really good at turning my head and coughing.
Widen out the camera, everybody. Here.
I'll just lay out on the table and just go, take me.
We have the paper. We just have the paper. We put it over the table.
Yeah.
I hate the paper. Am I the only one that hates the paper?
It's stupid.
Why do they still have the paper?
It's super gross.
I hate when they pull the paper on the bed and they're like, oh, sit on the bed. And I'm like, I don't want it. I'm going to ruin the paper.
Yeah, the paper seems
like
a
waste. Then you got to throw it away.
There's always that dark secret of just like, you know, if you're stripped down, you're like, you don't want me to sit on the paper because I might leave something behind.
Yeah.
It's been a rough day back
then. I've been at the convention all day. You know, I got leaky butt.
Yeah. No.
You went right to it. Yeah. You're right between the lines on that one.
Last time I went to a doctor, they were just like, your cholesterol is really good. And all this other stuff, like, you're doing all right. Like, the asthma is a real bummer. And making it harder for you to lose weight, but like, yeah, you're fine. So yeah. I've been riding that for a good.
See, and that's the thing. Like when I go in there and like they do the blood test and they do the blood pressure on me because I have to get these checkups all the time. Yeah. I'm always waiting for it.
Yeah.
Like, do you eat chicken wings every other day?
It's like, what? No.
And so they're always like, oh, your pressure is so over such. And I'm like, is that good? Like, oh, it's real good. I'm like,
I'm always worried they're going to start pumping up the blood pressure thing. It just says Burger King here. What is that?
It's just a scale. It hits the king.
Like, right on. The last time I went to the doctor was for my when they diagnosed me with celiac disease, which I later ended up being false. And
a misdiagnosis.
Did you find out that was false?
He went
to
a doctor.
I had blood tests. I got them back at E3, and it was in 2010, right? 2011, something like that.
Oh, yeah. This is one of the best Colin stories of all time when you realize what a crackpot he was because he was waiting for these test results forever. They called you, right, just as we got on the plane.
Yeah.
So Colin is, I'll be Colin in this scenario for viewers watching at home. Colin's me. I'm on the window. He's in the middle seat. And literally the phone rings as the plane starts to taxi to take off. And Colin is talking on the phone. And then the lady comes by. She's like, you have to get off the phone, sir. We're taxiing. I'm like, all right. And then he just buries his head into my chest to keep talking. And the lady comes by. She's like, oh, we will stop the plane. He's like, I'm getting test results.
And then I went. I didn't know what celiac disease was. I got the E3, and then we got to the war room, and I googled it. Then I read about it. Then I cried. I started crying.
No bagels, no pizza, no beer.
And I'm an Italian, you know, New York man, and it was really hard for me to bear that I couldn't eat semolina anymore or anything like that. Yeah. So then I just accepted it. They were like, "You should really get an endoscopy because that's the gold standard. Like that will your blood tests indicate you have it. You probably shouldn't get your hopes up, but."
You should do it for sure.
You should probably.
You should just know.
Yeah. So then I just went about 2.5 years, just assuming that I had it, going gluten free for like a week at a time, being like, I can't do it. And then like eating it, feeling guilty
paying
and terrible.
Paying $35 for a
gluten free pizza from Patchy's like once a week. Then in November, last November, I finally was like, let's just do it. Because I was having I have like really bad stomach. And they were like, you know, they put me under and I was talking to the doctor. I was going under and I was like, I hope you guys don't find anything. He's like, don't count on it. That was the last thing he said to me. And then I zonked out. I woke up. He's like, all right, so we'll have...
It's a horrible thing to say to someone.
He's like, we took the samples from your stomach. He's like, there's no visual evidence that anything's wrong, but we're going to send the samples back. You have multiple ulcers. He's like, I'm a total warrior wart. So like, I'm totally paranoid. So
do you walk around unplugging toaster ovens and Wii U gamepads?
and then my girlfriend and I went to Tahoe for vacation, and he called me there, and he's like, "So turns out you don't have celiac disease." I'm like, "Are you sure?" And he's like, "Yeah, we are. This is 100% sure that you do not have celiac disease." I'm like, "He's like, your blood tests say you do, but this says you don't." So,
go nuts.
Yeah, he's like, "Well, we still want to treat you. You should come back in so we can talk, and we still want to treat you." Like you are a celiac, so you should have a gluten-free diet. I'm like, nah, I don't think so. And then
threw your phone in the Tahoe River.
Yeah, and I was like, and then I just never. I was so mad at them.
Stuck the phone into a sandwich.
I was like, I was so, and I got off the phone with my girlfriend. Like, I thought I was in denial about it, and I told her, I'm like, they told me I didn't have it. Like, she's like, you're a fucking liar, because she's a doc, she's a forensic psychologist. So she's like, they diagnose you with this, like you have it. And I'm like, no, I really don't have it. The only thing they said to me was like. Your blood test came back and you have really low vitamin D, and they're like, that just means you don't get a lot of sunlight. This is San Francisco. And I'm like, yeah, that's the reason. Maybe it's because I don't fucking leave my house.
So depressed because I have celiac disease.
Exactly. Yeah. So that was my celiac adventure.
We worked in a basement for several years, and there was some vitamin D deficiencies on staff for a little bit there.
Y'all got rickets?
We're getting real close. If it wasn't that, it was going to be scurvy or something.
Yeah.
So,
whatever.
You don't want to get scurvy.
No. Nobody does.
That's the pirate disease.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Nick.
Greg,
what's your topic?
I got another fun topic from Twitter.
Another fun one.
Ladies and gentlemen, if you have a topic for the show, please feel free to follow me on Twitter at @Nick_Scarpino. Tweet me your topics, like the Furious Iceberg.
That's pretty good.
I guess it's pretty good. In 10 years, should Disney reboot Star Wars episodes 1 through 3? It'll have been 25 years, and doing a good take on Vader's fall is needed, which I think I agree with.
First of all, the fact that it's been 25 years since 1999 at that point is just scary.
Isn't that trippy?
15 years right now, which is insane. I remember seeing that abomination live with my...
You used to say, at least the people going to die. You love it.
I went to see it with my brother and my dad. My dad took me out of school. I was in 9th grade when it came out. Or 10th grade. And I remember seeing it, and I'm like, oh, that was pretty good. You know, I like walked out of there. Yeah, I was like, all right, I can do that. Like the Darth Maul action, it was pretty cool.
Maul was pretty bad. We can all agree the Maul was badass.
Yeah, he was awesome. There was some terrible, like the Rick Oley or whatever, the pilot that like was the worst actor in the world. Was it like that stuck out to me? Jar Jar Binks sucked, but overall, I was okay. And then like slowly, like you could see it with my brother and my dad. We were talking about the same thing.
Wait a minute.
We went out to lunch afterwards, and we're like, okay, that was pretty good. Then we like went out to dinner, and I was like, but wait, like. That pod racing scene kind of sucked, you know, and like the announcers were a little weird, right? And then like a month later, like we would meet again and be like, everything was the guys in the beginning were racist Asian stereotypes, and And then everything slowly started falling apart for everyone. I think that's the way it went with everyone. Some people act, maybe I'm wrong, but some people act like they went in and they hated it immediately. And I don't know if that happened.
I ended up kind of, like, at that point I was relatively indifferent about Star Wars, even before those had come out. But at the time, I was friends with a lot of people that worked at a movie theater chain. I was dating someone who ran a movie theater.
Yeah, tell us about that.
So it was a lot of popcorn. You know what I'm saying?
No. I think so.
It was dark time. So I got to see that the night before it came out, or maybe one night even before that. So but it was a bunch of movie theater employees, and at some point you've seen so many free movies, they're just like, man, fuck all this shit. So a lot of us came out of that going like, that was not so good. Like, not like outraged and freaking out, but even the people that loved Star Wars were just like, I don't know about it. Like, Star Wars. But I kind of came out of it saying like, whatever, that was lame. But then I had this like advanced knowledge for 2 days and like really wanted to use it. And was like, it took everything I had.
Oh, you're like that guy that read the end of the Harry Potter book 7.
Exactly.
And he immediately ran out and told me about it.
Yeah. I wanted to do that, but I ended up not quite doing it. I was in a band at the time. We were playing shows out and about, and the day that movie opened, the day before, I guess. So it was like, they were going to show it at midnight. And they decided somewhere in the South Bay, they decided like, what if we got some bands to play in the parking lot while people were waiting in line for Star Wars? So like, here we are, rapping in front of kids waiting to see Star Wars. And it's just like, I'm just kind of like obliquely referencing things in the movie that won't make any sense to that. I can't remember anything too specific other than
midichlorian
counts. Some people got pushed into pits and shit. It was really hard having a microphone in front of this sea of people, many of which had come in costume.
Yeah,
of course.
Yeah.
And one of the other guys, this guy Ben, that was in the group.
Kenobi?
With us, he was in there. We decided we were going to do like a Star Wars costume contest thing, and the winner was someone dressed up in a full like X-Wing like pilot outfit, helmet.
Sweet.
Like great looking. Just like, spent a ton of time on it. And Ben, good guy. He's come a long way. Just grabbed him, gave him the biggest wedgie. In the middle of this parking lot, the poor kid just wanted to fucking see Star Wars in peace, and here we were swearing in front of them, talking about how we didn't much care for Star Wars, and then he had to give him the wedgie. And I don't know, the whole thing.
Sadly, that wasn't the worst thing that happened to that kid that night.
No, I guess not. I think at the end of the night, he had to see Star Wars. And we're like, I dressed up.
See, I'm with Colin. I think I was sort of similar. You go in with you wanting and liking it more than you probably should have, right? At the first one, because you're like, it's Star Wars. It's the first Star Wars we've seen in my, like, in forever, however long, what, 10 years, 15 years? And, no, longer than that.
Longer than that. 16 years.
And so I think we all got out, and we had been hyped because those trailers were awesome, right?
Right.
Were,
Meet like Joe that. Black was it? I remember people used to go see Meet Joe Black just to see the trailer.
Just see the trailer, right? Yeah, that awesome line.
There
like,
wasn't the internet yet.
I wouldn't go see Meet Joe Black because Meet Joe Black was dope.
Claire Filani, what
actually,
up?
Really good movie. No, that's Claire Filani.
What's
she's watching.
She's
actually
Rats.
She's a fan. Where'd she go? Craig's. So you see the trailer, and you have the cool line where he's like, "At last, we will reveal ourselves to the Jedi. Last, we'll have our revenge." And you're like, "What's gonna happen? It's gonna be so good." And then you go in, and it was not good, and you don't want to believe it because I didn't want to believe it because I was like, "It doesn't matter what happened in this one. There's gonna be two more,
and they're that's gonna what
totally
I felt
make
too.
It up." Right?
And I thought the second one especially.
Like, they gotta tell a story here, man. They gotta set it up. It's just a startup story. They gotta set it up.
I don't worry about midichlorians. Whatever. He's gonna have some cool spin on that. Lawrence Kasdan's gonna come in. He's gonna write the second one. It's gonna be the bomb. Then the second one came out, and you were like, "Oh no!"
The second
this
one
is not going to get better. This is just going down the rabbit hole.
Yeah. The second one was the one I was actually starting to get personally offended
because
I
they
didn't
were
see
like
it in theaters.
Oh, they had. I mean, you're watching the Hayden Christensen and Natalie Portman have zero chemistry. They are not falling in love. You do not believe this at all. It's as if that was like the first day they met was the love scene, which is like sacrilege. If you're a director, you don't do that to your cast, but it was just terrible. And then by the time you got to the third one, you're like, I just gotta see it end. I just want to, you know, it's like when you've got a dying grandmother and you're like, I love her to death, but she's
you
in
take
pain
the pillow.
And you just slowly start, or like what Colin does every time you turn around with Portillo, he just goes to squeeze his neck.
I'm not sure if I ever actually saw the third one.
Really?
Yeah,
it was pretty good.
I'm not sure. Whoa. I did either.
I saw the second one drunk in a hotel room in New York with someone from Rockstar. I was like flying out there to see something. And just like we had some time to kill, it's just like, turn on the TV, what's going on? We've been drinking on the plane the whole way out. and that was on. I was like, yes, watch this. I just remember it being bad.
But Anakin, really bad. I have the high ground.
Like, sadly, really they bad. All had good parts of them. Like, I remember really good parts. Like, the fight, all the fights with Darth Maul were awesome. I liked all the stuff with where he goes to the clone factory in the second one. The fight at the end between Anakin and Obi-Wan was actually pretty cool in the third one.
Up until the stupid, he gets his legs and arms chopped off in one kind of just, I have the high ground.
He's
you
like,
fought. You had this amazing fight forever. And it's just one half circle.
Yeah, he's like, you're only 5 feet away from me. Don't try it, because I'm 2 feet higher than you are. I'm
going. He was reading a lot of military strategy freaking books.
Planet of the Apes. They're all over the damn place, and you can't jump over them. I mean, it's the stupidest thing.
The problem was, like, I actually, and we've said this before on the show. Like, I feel like the movies actually got worse. A lot of people feel like that. I actually feel like Episode One, strictly because of Darth Maul, was actually really superior to the other two. Because
at least he was interesting. Everyone will agree with that.
Yeah, a lot of people think that that's the worst one.
I thought 3 was good. I enjoy. Now, I want to fall. I've always been indifferent to Star Wars. I've never been in love with it. So it's like, whatever. These are fun movies. Yeah, I'm fun. Yeah.
But I do remember, you know, I really loved Star Wars when I was a kid. I was really obsessed with Star Wars when I was a kid. And you know, I remember that feeling of, like, seeing that Lucasfilm, that greenish Lucasfilm logo. And then, like, the 20th century. And I was, like, so fucking excited. You know, then the scroll happens. It talks about the Trade Federation and all these kinds of things. I'm like, this is really interesting. And I actually like the first 10 minutes of the movie, like, where they're on the ship.
And, yeah, that was cool.
And it's like Obi-Wan and Qui-Gon are sneaking onto the Trade Federation ship or whatever, and they use the lightsaber to, like, cut through the door. And
they move, like, super fast for some reason.
Yeah, that was the first time where I was like, oh, Jedis are cool.
Yeah, but it quickly went down. Like, and so there's other cool scenes in it. Like, I love the scene. A lot of people underrate the scene with Darth Maul in the desert when he first fights them, and he comes on the speeder bike,
nails.
and he does a flip over the bike and or off the bike, and then only opens one side of his lightsaber and starts fighting them or whatever. And I was like, this is so, because you know he has the double sided lightsaber, he doesn't even need to use it.
Yeah, you saw in the preview, and you're like, when's it gonna come out?
And then that last fight is,
like, epic.
Really, really. And I always say, I love the scene where Darth Maul. It's very subtle. Where Darth Maul's backing up towards the closed door, and he just puts his arm out. Or whatever, and like, goes, and like, and like, yeah, and like, and like, sends some like thing striking into the mouth. Like, so awesome, you know. But other than that, it sucked. And the second one,
should they reboot it in 10 years?
And I just want to say, the second one ruined Boba Fett forever.
Made him better, you mean? They gave him a backstory.
No, it made him a fucking clone. I don't want to go down this road again with you. All right, we've gone down this road before. Boba Fett was sacred, and they fucking ruined him. He's a shitty fucking clone. All right, period. No, they should reboot them. They should. Go back in time and undo them. They can use that Disney money.
Here's the thing: is that 10 years isn't far away, right?
Ten years from now is pretty far, but I mean,
not in terms of movies, because they have the when's the next one come out? 2015?
Yeah, they're gonna keep going. Yeah,
then they're gonna have
Wade, though, right?
2016, I think. Now they're talking.
Well, it's 2015. Yeah, so
if Harrison Ford broke his fat foot.
If it's 2015, then it's 2017, then it's 2019.
But then they're going to do the...
Where's the Gary Whitta one?
The odd years will be like your Gary Whitta movies and that sort of stuff.
So I think by the time we get through the movies that are already announced, there's going to be no reason to restart it, to reboot it.
I think they will, though.
They'll have something. They'll need to do something at that point, though, won't they? I mean, you know, maybe that'll just be like, we re-released the original trilogy again and we unfucked them. I don't know.
I'd like to see it happen. I'd like to see him give it to... Yeah, 10 years from now, they're like, JJ, you want to take another crack at it? Because JJ will do a couple and probably go away for a while.
I'd rather see new stories, though. Why do we need to see? We already saw it.
And I would hope that there would be like someone, like, you know, in 10 years' time, there'd be like a new J.J. Abrams or someone to step in and do it.
Like, I'm sure there will be, but like, imagine how amazing it would be if the entire world was like, everyone can unanimously agree that those were kind of mistakes, and now we're gonna all rise up and support 3 more that just build into that same original story.
But it's just going to fuck the timeline. You're only rebooting the 3 movies. That's even more crazy. When they reboot all of Spider-Man, that kind of makes sense.
Well, if they reboot all 9 of them and just start with those 3?
Yeah, I mean, that's probably what they would end up doing, but...
Ooh, I don't know.
That's hardcore. If you
touch a New Hope or Empire or Jedi, man... But I don't want to live on that world.
But like 10 to 15 years from now, who cares what you think? You're not in the movie scene. They're not making them for you.
Come to think of
it. Yeah, I mean, they're not making those for you. They're making them for kids.
It's good, right?
No, that's true. I couldn't imagine. Like, those movies are so sacred. You know, like, the cast in those movies especially, like, sacred. You know, like, A New Hope is... It ages well. It's all weird and fucked up. Like, when you watch it, it's not very well made. But, like, it's a really special movie. Empire is really the epitome of that series. Sure. And... you know, you can't imagine.
I couldn't
imagine. I couldn't imagine like recasting those things. Now, I will say this real quick. This is funny because I swore off a few episodes ago. I was like, I'm never, you know, because they got rid of the expanded universe's canon,
right,
which
yeah.
deeply insulted me. Mm. And I was like, I'm no longer going to give a shit about Star Wars.
Big Masters of Terrascasi fan, huh?
Huge fan of that, yeah. that fine PS1 fighting yeah. game. and no, but I spent, like I was saying, I spent like hundreds, if not thousands of dollars on this shit when I was a kid and just time, like read every book. And I felt like it was all real and it's just all like, no, it's fan fiction. But
Timothy Zahn's a Joker. Get him out of here.
But episode 7. So when this stuff happened with Han Solo, or Harrison Ford, as we know him in real life, it happened and he broke his leg, I guess, or he really fucked his leg up on the set. But then all the stuff started leaking about the plot. And I don't know if you guys saw this or whatever.
It was like, on Ain't It Cool character. News
and stuff. Yeah, and like, I was like, if this is true, I have to be, and I tweeted him, like, I have to be kind of honest with you, like, I'm pretty stoked about the plot.
What's the plot? Just said that, I knew that it was like revolved around Han Solo a lot or whatever. What the fuck? I knew it revolved around Han Solo. Okay.
Hold on, I'm gonna answer it. Hello? Okay, have a good night. Bye bye. Sorry, that was our landlord. We haven't paid rent yet.
I love it. I love it so much.
Evening of the first, on you immediately.
Yeah. No, like, what the fuck? Well, because I saw him before and he went out, he goes to his son's house for dinner and he gets away. So anyway, the plot, just very brief, like there's not much about it, but it's about, and turn it off if you don't want to know. It's about apparently Han Solo leading a search party for Luke Skywalker who's gone missing. And like that sounds kind of awesome. Like I got to be totally honest with you, like old Han Solo is looking for like his old friend. You know, because Han Solo is like in his 70s, or at least Harrison Ford is.
That's actually really cool.
So like I'm like that sounds kind of rad.
And then
they'll
find a young Luke Skywalker on the planet Genesis.
Again, remember like but they could do the original 3 again and not touch anything and just build into the rest of the canon. Like they've already been made. We already know where they have to go. As long as they wind up with basically the main thing of
just retell those stories dead, and just go like, hey, look guys, like, you know, the people that were stewards of this franchise before suck, so here are these 3 movies again and we fixed them.
You can't do that. Or replace them. Do it.
I think you could.
No way. You have to reboot the whole universe.
I don't think you do.
I think that would be like super cool if they rebooted the whole universe at this point. That'd be really interesting.
Wow.
I'm sure they will eventually, but
probably.
Disney paid $4 billion for that fucking
company. I mean, they're gonna make those after all of us are dead.
I was gonna say, I guess like the analog to this is Star Trek, right?
Sure.
Where really the J.J. Abrams Star Trek undid all of the other Star Treks. So,
right. But you know, that would have been interesting nods to it and stuff. Yeah. And I thought that first movie was awesome.
Yeah. You know, like second one?
It was fine. That's
the one with the Cumberbatch running around? Correct. I think I saw that one.
Con.
I forgot that one. Yeah, it didn't have the
con. It was
con
forgettable. It was good. It was entertaining.
Yeah,
that's as much as can be said about it.
I really like the first one.
I cry at the beginning of the first one every single time. I tell this whole story all the time. I cannot watch the beginning of Star Trek. The J.J. Abrams
when
reboot.
Thor dies?
When Thor dies. Mm. When Chris Hemsworth, he has a name, Greg.
Thor.
Yeah. When he said, when he's talking, and he's doing all the stuff, and like, do one man band, like, killing the Romulan ship in front of him, and he hears the crying of his baby.
Yeah.
And then she's like, and then they had this totally normal conversation about, like, as his son's born, as he's, like, rocketing toward the ship. I man tear up every single time. Yeah. It's so good.
It's the birth of James T. Kirk, man.
Yeah,
a legend like, is born.
What are we gonna name him? She's like, let's name him after your father. He's like, Tiberius. No, that's the worst. Let's name him after your dad. Let's name him James. So good.
I'm like getting like,
damn it,
pins and needles on my face. Just
so good.
Oh,
anyway,
just like the other famous line from what we've been talking about tonight, the sand. It's so coarse, gets everywhere. I hate the sand.
Hayden Christensen is like,
oh my god, no. That's the line I was trying to. That's what I was trying to remember. Where he's like, "You're fine though. You're like the what did he say? How does that whole thing go? It's terrible."
Thing about Hayden Christensen, remember, I think it's bad direction. He's great in Shattered Glass. Everybody go watch Shattered Glass. Shattered Glass, fantastic flick. Just putting it out there because I'm a journalist.
He's a good actor. That's the sad thing is that he just wasn't given very much to work with. Probably not given very many takes and. Probably had no idea what he was doing and he's seeing because everything was green around him.
Working on a green screen, that can't be easy. Yeah.
So I say no, don't reboot. Nick, okay. What do you say?
I say yes. Jeff, what do you say?
Fuck it, dude. It's just Star Wars.
It's just Star Wars. Colin, last question to you of the evening.
It's coarse and rough and irritating.
I'm irritating.
It gets everywhere.
It gets
I have. That's even worse than I remember it.
Colin, if you had to
That's a good take. What?
Which character is the lesser of these two evils? Okay, mm-hmm. You got your Jar Jar Binks, or your Bane.
What do you mean? Bane is Bane and Jar Jar are different. Bane is an essential character. Yes. And Jar Jar Binks is just the worst.
I mean, Jar Jar Binks is one of the worst characters in the history of cinema. Like, I don't like Bane or Rises, but I'm not going to say he's worse than Jar Jar.
Bane is the best, dude. We've tread this.
He's arguably the best character.
How do you feel about Bane?
I'm kind of indifferent on the topic.
What do you think of Rises?
I didn't see it.
Oh my god!
Really?
Oh,
okay.
Yeah. No. It's so
you did the right. You made the right choice.
So here's the thing that happens: you see movies for free for a while. You date someone who works at a movie theater. When all that goes away, the last thing you want to do is go to a movie theater.
She might be there.
No, and it's just like at some point. A couple of things. Like, I don't like seeing movies with people.
Yeah.
Because you're used to seeing them late at night with no one. And then also, like, I just at some point was like, I hate hanging out at movie theaters.
Sure.
Yeah, I feel the same way.
And it's one of those things, like, I'm amazed.
Over going to the movie theater.
Why the fuck do movie theaters still exist?
I don't know, but
this conversation just came out.
This is fucking terrible.
Yeah. Don't ever want them to die. I love that long walk down, like, the carpet with your popcorn, and it's spilling all over the place, and you look up, and that's not your theater, and you realize it's all the way on the other hall. And you got to deal with
You're describing
kids.
All things I hate.
Oh, I love it. I like the smell of a movie theater. I like when, like, you get out to go to the bathroom, and you have to run because they don't stop the movie, and it's really quiet in the hallways. You know, I love the whole experience. I'm always gonna love going.
I have
movies.
In terms of just like distance to screen and all that sort of stuff. I have a better sound system and television in my home to watch those films.
Day and day digital. I'm telling you,
totally.
Yep. Like, there you go. It's over, Nick.
Just lean into it.
It's never gonna be over.
It won't be over, but you'll be paying $25 for a movie ticket before.
I'll pay it. Yeah.
Because the digital day and date thing's gonna happen eventually for sure. Like with everything.
Yeah.
And then movie theaters are gonna start to close, and you're gonna only have
there'll
premium
boutique
movie theaters.
Theaters and stuff like that. Yeah. I mean, yeah. I feel like you already see a lot of that because exhibitors have to figure out new ways to bring people into this like dying thing. I guess that business is still afloat for what it is. But that's why you have your Alamo Draft Houses and like we serve beer. Come to a movie theater. Please come to our movie theater. We have beers.
Right.
But once you can book seats, it'll be a little bit better.
The theater in Petaluma, they have the shaky seats.
Oh, do they?
They have
interesting.
I can't remember the D-box. They have D-box seats, and you reserve D-box seats. You have to pay a little bit more.
Yeah.
But they are the best seats in the house, and also for some movies like Fast and the Furious when. They were in Brazil, like when it was like doing that pan around, like the seat kind of leaned, and you're like, "This is really dumb and hilarious."
I'm just thinking like that. Alamo Draft House. They're building one down in the Mission, right?
Yeah,
where you can just book your seat.
Right.
That's a big thing. But even then, I'm gonna have some annoying person around me, and I hate them.
Yeah, no, fuck people.
Fuck people, indeed, ladies and gentlemen. Nick, that was your topic.
That was my topic, Greg.
Don't click off yet.
Don't click off.
As always, Nick, your topic was driven by the community.
By Twitter, mostly Twitter.
All right. Well, we're introducing something new here on the Game Over Greggy show.
Correct.
For next week's show, the people get to pick what your topic's going to
be. Yeah, you guys have been awesome, by the way. So thank you so much for sending all those amazing...
Keep sending them. Nick_Scarpino.
Nick_Scarpino. All the topics, I write them all down. We go through them together and we talk and they're all amazing. They always get a laugh. If we don't ever do your topic, by the way, just know that we talk about it. They always get a laugh.
And just know that the one to beat is still what would happen if you had to rename Earth because the name was already taken.
Which is genius.
That was still the best one. So if you can beat that one, I'll be very impressed.
If you can beat it, it's coming on the show. So to sort of say thank you and to kind of give the power back to the audience... Greg had this great idea. Greg, you want to describe it, or would you like me to?
I don't mind you doing it.
Okay.
He's giving the power back to you now.
I want to let you guys pick the topic for next week's show.
Retain some of the power.
If you are we going to put these on screen? Is that
you have to be. We'll put them in the description, too, in case you're on mobile. But if you're watching us on YouTube, sorry, MP3 people, you have to wait for this episode to go live.
Right.
What we're doing is putting on screen right now two choices,
two
thumbnails.
On this side, you have topic one. This is also from Twitter. Pregnancy scares. So that could be the potential topic. For next week's show. Topic over here, kind of by my face.
I'm going to put
masking
them both
Greg's
right
face.
There. They're not
right
masking here, anybody's face.
They're going to mask Greg's face right here. Is what would you do if you met your clone? So click on whatever video you want to vote.
Exactly. No. Well, what happens is I understand you're going to want to watch what happens on both sides of the videos. Whichever one gets the most thumbs up is what will win.
One.
So you click on both. You can see Nick's talk about pregnancy scares and the clones. Whichever one has the most thumbs up by the time we record next week on Wednesday, that's the winner.
Awesome. That sounds great.
Yeah.
Cool.
Gonna be good stuff.
I'm excited.
Sounds all right.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's been another episode of the Game Over Greggy show. Remember, every week, four, sometimes five best friends gather around this table.
So many best friends.
Each What'd you say?
Said I have so many best friends.
Yeah.
Yeah.
4 to 5, and then we cycle people
right,
in.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah.
They're no longer my best friend anymore.
Best friends. I want to be
Jeff's best friend. Yeah. You think Jeff will hang out with me after?
I think Jeff's best friends with us now.
Yeah. Sure.
It happened. Cool, yeah. Yeah. Sure. Absolutely.
Now I know where you live. So
exactly.
I can just
you have all the power now.
Yeah. Now I've got the power.
Remember, we post the show every Friday as an MP3 over at GameOverGreggy.bandcamp.com. You buy it for $1. It's the entire show. You have a good time. If you don't want to spend the dollar, we totally understand that and don't judge you. Instead, Monday through Thursday, you get each and one of our topics broken out at YouTube.com/GameOverGreggy. Friday, the entire show goes up as one giant video for free. We hope you enjoy that. Buy t-shirts at DistroLions.com/GameOverGreggy. Thanks for coming out to support us at Rooster Teeth Expo. That's what it stands for, RT Expo.
Yeah, that's correct.
Oh. Yeah, 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 yeah. Just wanted to let you know.
Sounds cool when you say like RTX, though.
RTX Red Rock, that game.
Yeah, that's true, too. That could be another one. Really. Jeff.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for coming.
Oh, thanks for having me.
It's a pleasure hanging out with you.
This has been great.
We love you.
Yeah, I'll be your friend.
Yeah, absolutely.
I think we're friends now, okay? We've covered that. We're friends.
Nick, you're friends. Yeah, we'll get him on Facebook.
Are we all friends?
He'll give you
Can I follow him on Twitter?
I'll send you a LinkedIn request.
That's the ultimate friendship.
Yeah.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's been a pleasure serving you this evening. I'm your friend, Greg.